Hey!
Hey, what up?
Welcome to the first Ape Audio podcast. I'm here with my two pals, Patrick and Ian.
Hey, what's up, man? Guys? What's How's it going?
What's up?
How's it going, brother?
Pretty good, pretty good. Nice. So, what's the struggle that we've endured to get this shit set up? Let the audience know.
About 2 months of fucking hard work.
Yeah. Basically just trying to get internet set up and getting this nice little accessory going here.
Hell yeah. Hell yeah.
3 hours of ironing.
Yeah, so we laid this green screen out on the table, or these two laid the green screen out on the table. I just bought it and kind of threw it
right
in the
here.
Door and then left. And apparently they spent 3 fucking hours ironing that shit out.
Dude, and it was the worst on this fucking table.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure this table's pretty warped by now, but it's all good. That's the job.
Oh, yeah.
Cool.
Holds it up.
So, basically what we want to talk about today is what we want to do with the podcast and what kind of content we want to bring to you guys, the listeners and the watchers. So I guess I'll just start with Ian. Like, when we first brought this idea up, it was kind of just nothing. It was like, hey, you listen to podcasts? Yeah, I listen to podcasts. You want to do a podcast? Okay. What do you want to do it on? Music.
Pretty
basically,
much.
That was like the starting point for us. But like, what did you kind of envision from that moment to like where we are now?
No, just, you know, I'm always talking to people about music anytime they're in, you know, this space because it's such a creative space. And
yeah.
I guess, and you know, this is what we do musically here as well. So I just needed to talk about music and kind of thought it would be worth recording because the conversations are always so fruitful, right? Between like everybody, like there's always good conversation as long as people are into it. And I've heard music podcasts before and thought it'd be a good idea to just, you know, kind of start documenting all this kind of stuff, all these talks.
For sure.
There's this one called, I think it's called Dissected, and they basically just take like songs that you've heard like a million times and they just like kind of like go into the nitty gritty with like theory and like production and like all that kind of stuff. So it kind of just gives you like replay value over like songs that you've heard before. Yeah.
So it's kind of like Genius for people who are actually nerdy about music and don't just want to ambiguously dissect lyrics and just make shit up.
I don't know. Some of those Genius annotations are pretty fucking good, man.
Yeah.
Fair enough. So what did you see from like, what's your goal here? Like, what are we trying to accomplish?
I'm not entirely sure what we're trying to do here, fellas.
I'm trying not to spill beer on my sweater.
I think just getting out to the local music scene is a pretty good start for me. It's getting to know people around here, getting to get your feet dirty a little bit. Hell yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, that's kind of like the big thing for me. Like, I listened to like a couple photography podcasts and there was this one host that was just like, they basically said the most fulfilling thing for them to do was interact with their community, because like if you try to grab onto something bigger than that, like right off the bat, it's probably just going to piss you off. You're not going to accomplish much. You're going to feel like you're kind of just like spinning the gears, but not really getting anywhere. So I thought it'd be really cool for us to kind of get in touch with the local music scene, which is a thriving one, but it's not one that's super well documented or like
documented at all.
Yeah, exactly. Like, unless you're right in it, chances are you're not hearing about it, you know? So I think this is a cool opportunity if we're able to grow this podcast to get some eyes on the scene that normally wouldn't be checked.
Expand the network a bit.
Yeah.
I don't even hear about shows unless Ian tells me.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know anything that's going
on. It's a weird niche, and it's crazy because, like, the Tri-Cities is full of amazing musical talent. Like,
Of all styles, too.
Yeah. It's wild, but, like, just nobody can really get a foothold because it's just a small niche. Like, if you know, you know, and if you don't, you're not going to hear about it kind of thing. You know what I mean? Like, it's not like we have huge venues for people to go play at. Like, right now, the shit that Have Hope is doing and Tri-City Hardcore and like the shows they're putting on at Harmony Lunch is like it's definitely a good start, because like you can put on a show at Maxwell's, but chances are only people who are like frequently going to concerts and shit are gonna show up at that places, that kind of place. But when you have people performing at Harmony Lunch, which is like a staple of Waterloo and has been for years and years and years,
part of the culture,
it starts getting the word out to people who wouldn't normally stumble across that kind of music, you know.
Yeah,
and like I watch videos of performances at Harmony Lunch, and the crowds are wild. Like there's a really wide range of people that show up there, people I wouldn't ever expect to see. Like it, I'm sure you guys remember going to shows at the Schwaben all the time back in the day. Like there's a pretty specific kind of crowd that would hang out there.
Emo. Yeah.
And back emo as fuck. Yeah. Scene bitches, that was, all that.
Yeah.
but that was like a great roots thing to happen. And it's an awesome thing that like a lot of us share.
I think that's the Harmony shows and stuff like that. It's kind of like showing that there's still like a flame, you know?
Yeah.
In that, very small one, but it's still there. Yeah,
sure.
Yeah, but it's been going pretty strong. You know, the Harmony shows have been, you know, they've been going on for, I don't really know how long. Like, I know many, many months.
I think it's coming up on probably close to a year at this point.
Is Have Hope Kyle Wappler's?
Yeah, Have Hope is Kyle Wappler's.
Nice.
Yeah, Kyle Wappler, yeah, doing End Dog Death Crew Hardcore 519, I think. Yeah. Yeah. The Death Crew Hardcore 519. I think that's what it's called, right? Yeah. Yeah, and they are pretty much just like another, I guess, like a promotions. Booking agency, promoters that they kind of like run these shows together.
Yeah.
At least they label that they're always co-labeled when they're, you know, putting these shows up and stuff like that.
I'm not sure of like the exact semantics of it. Like,
yeah.
I'm more aware of and have been involved with like Have Hope, like knowing Kyle for so many years now and seeing like what he started Have Hope at and like where it is now is just like absolutely wild to me. But it's like the perfect example of like if you just persevere in this scene, like you can really get a foothold.
Yeah.
Do you remember 519punk.com?
No, I don't.
That was such a
tell us website, tell us about 519punk.com.
You'd go to the homepage and it would just be like these random shows that were coming up, and then there was just a little forum on the side, people just selling music equipment and shit.
It's pretty cool. Nice.
That sounds awesome.
Yeah. Oh, my first wall pedal off there.
Ooh, I assume it inevitably has died at this point. Yeah.
Too bad.
Well, maybe it's still up. You never know. Some old forum, you know, some old formatted
online forum. I love stumbling across shit like that.
GeoCities.
Oh my god. Yeah.
Pixo. All the classics. All the hits.
Pixo shut down, didn't it?
Probably. I assume some other Live
Journal.
Live Journal. Yeah, I had a Pixo site and I was pretty proud of it. I literally just grabbed like all sorts of CGI desktop backgrounds and plastered them all over this page that could barely load anymore because it took up so much fucking RAM.
Take up all the bandwidth of this site.
All the girls in high school would have those websites.
Yeah, there's Pixo.
So stupid.
Why do you think I made one?
Because.
Because I was all the girls in high school.
You were?
He was all the girls.
Yeah.
That's pretty interesting.
Yeah.
They should bring them back.
Girls?
No, Pixo.
Yeah. I want there to be a renaissance, if you will. I want to go back to the old ways. I want to have a MySpace theme song that when everybody comes to my page, it just plays like some Bring Me the Horizon or some shit like that.
Yeah. Or just even go more back, Neopets.
Hell, yo, Neopets is still...
It's still kicking?
Thing.
Oh,
yeah.
Man, I didn't even know that.
It is. Just
been going on for so long.
Just like Homestar Runner, I check in on both of those websites like once a year. I check in and I go, okay, they're still here.
Wow.
Everything's right in the world.
As soon as it goes off.
I don't know, dude. That's when I'm unplugging the cord. I don't need internet anymore. I don't need any technology. When Neopets is dead, my soul is also dead. The funny thing is I never really played it. Like I played it for like maybe a month and realized that it was just like super garbage. Like there was way better things to get involved with.
Like
yeah. So anyway, I think fuck Neopets. I think we all decided that we want to let you guys get to know us a little bit throughout this episode, and we're going to talk about kind of like what inspired us to take our music to where it is right now, and the kind of stuff that we listen to, and how we got to a point of listening to certain genres and artists and whatever.
Yeah.
That's a good way.
Little icebreaker. Little musical icebreaker for you.
Yeah, I want to let you in.
We will let you in.
So who...
Come in.
Does anybody want to start? Like, do you guys have any, like, super cringy musical memories from, like, when you were a kid? Yeah.
Yeah.
I went to see Prozac. Like,
oh, you went to see them?
So they made out of Pepsi Taste Challenge. At
oh
Sports
my
World.
God!
Holy shit! All right.
I got to go backstage.
What?
It was fucking weird, man.
So you met like the non-animated.
Yeah.
Oh, what?
I am Simon, and this is Milo.
Got them. Dude, it was so fucking weird. Oh my god! And I was standing like right beside the stage too.
You were just kind of like.
I just never listened to the band after that.
What was the audience like? Like, do you recall?
Dead.
So they were just kind of like, sucks to be you.
I know.
Just everyone just kind of swaying a little bit.
So because of the show, you just went like, I never need to listen to these guys again?
I saw some girl from elementary school at the show.
Was it just you by yourself at the show?
No, my
mom. Like your mom went with you?
Yeah, I went with my fucking mom.
Nice.
Yeah, I think it was grade 4 that I went. I saw Juliana Gomez there. You remember her?
I have no idea.
And then she was like,
did you guys high five?
No.
Yeah.
When we went back to school and I wasn't listening to them anymore, she's like, you're not a real fan.
Oh,
she's like,
shit.
Calling me out on it. You know, like, oh. I don't fucking care. The band sucks.
That's Jesus wild.
Christ. Don't Prozac shame me.
Yeah. And then Finger 11 happened after that.
So oh.
Dude punch a chick in the face.
That's definitely a huge
did you go with your mom as well?
No, my dad this time.
Nice. Ooh. Yes.
Went to London.
Damn, that's a trip.
That's a field trip.
I think my first cringiest music experience was I had Aaron Carter on a cassette tape, and I used to build forts and listen to Aaron Carter all the fucking time.
How big were these forts?
They were pathetic.
Oh. What were they made of?
Just pillows. I would take
just
like
pillows.
Like cushions off of a couch,
no,
and I would just basically make a structure like in a nookshuck. It would just go straight up, one pillow on top, and I just throw a sheet on top, and I would just sit inside and listen to Aaron Carter and play the original Game Boy.
Christian, we can still hear you out here.
No, actually, I had a huge cassette player, and then just like these tiny, like, you know those crappy headphones you get that have like that aluminum band that go up over top. And they crush your ears in so fucking bad. Yeah, I used to bump Aaron Carter off of that shit.
How was the sound quality? Pretty good.
I don't even know. Probably awful.
Do you still have the tape?
No, I don't. I think at some point I stuck my fingers inside of it and just...
Oh, you started... Was it out of malice or were you just, you know, curious? Like, oh, what is this doing?
I think I was just
like,
curious and I wrecked the tape and I was like, oh, shit. My parents are going to fucking kill me if they find this thing.
They're like, thank God.
I destroyed Aaron Carter.
Oh, shit. I thought they would have been pretty happy. They're like, oh, my God, he's finally done listening to that. Yeah.
But, okay, so, like, I didn't ask for this cassette tape. My parents just kind of bought it for me, and I didn't know any better. Like, I was, like, we were super young when that shit was popular. Like, I'm thinking, like, 7, 8, maybe.
There's no excuse.
I knew I should be embarrassed while I listened to it.
Yeah.
I had at least that much sense of mind going on. Yeah. But like my first cringy conscious musical choice, you remember Crazy Town? Come, my lady. When that song came out and it was playing on Much Music, I was like, hell yeah. This is the greatest fucking song I've ever heard in my life. And I begged my parents to buy me a Crazy Town CD. And I didn't end up getting the CD or anything. We went to the store, and it has a parental advisory sticker on it. And not anymore. Not anymore. At this time, because this was kind of during a time when, like, Eminem was getting, like, a ton of flack on, like,
he
CNN
hates his mom.
And, like, Fox News. Like,
Columbine
stuff. Yeah, that kind of shit. Just, like, ridiculous artist propaganda going on. So,
did you know he took his ribs out?
He sucks his own dad.
So, basically, My mom saw the explicit content rating on it and was just like, there's no way in hell you're getting this Crazy Town CD. And I'm pretty sure, like, on the drive home, the song came, like, Butterfly came on the radio. And my mom's like, I love this song. And I'm like, God, you fucking damn it.
Mom, this is Crazy Town.
And part of me is so glad I never was purchased that record.
It's a blessing in disguise.
I don't know any other Crazy Town song, and I'm kind of glad I don't. But I did complain about it a lot that they refused to buy me that record. So the following year for Christmas, they said, okay, we'll buy you... it's worse. They're like, okay, we'll buy you any record you want. If it's got an explicit rating on it, it's fine. Like, you can pick it up. And I'm like, oh, this is tantalizing. You know what I picked? You know what? Okay, and this is another group that...
Jesse McCartney.
...was playing close.
Ashley Simpson.
No, not
B4-4.
Not at all, not at all. Damn. So this was another group that was playing all the time on Much Music. Swollen Members.
Oh, shit.
I asked for a Swollen Members CD.
I also only know one of their songs.
And it was amazing. I listened to that shit on repeat for like...
The song or the album?
The whole album. For like probably 2 years. And that was like the only CD I had. And both my parents hated it. They're like, this is the worst music we've ever heard. Except there was one song with Nelly Furtado. And they're like, hell yeah. I think it's called I'm Alive.
Why is she always singing about being alive and shit?
Yes, we get it.
So that's like my low point. So I think that's a good like starting point for my musical journey is like that's rock bottom.
Wow. Yeah. I'm pretty much in a similar boat. I think it was first conscious CD purchase with like just asking my parents if they could buy me it was, I think it was YTV's Big Fun Party Mix.
Oh.
And... You know, just watching shows on YTV, you know, getting into, like, the kiddie kind of anime stuff. No Dragon Ball Z, of course, because, you know, too violent. But,
you weren't allowed to watch
Dragon
Ball Z?
Oh, no, it was, yeah. I would, you know, you'd still watch it when they're asleep or whatever.
Can I pop in with a quick anecdote here?
Go for it.
So, me and my brother used to watch Dragon Ball, like, every Saturday or whatever when the new episodes would air. And during the theme song, which, as far as I understand, is different in Canada than it is in the rest of the world. Nobody else has the Dragon Ball. Dragon Ball Z. Nobody
really?
Else has that. Yeah, the intro is different in the rest of the world for some reason. During that intro, me and my brother used to try to go Super Saiyan. So we would just stand in front of the TV and we'd be like shirtless, like a bowl of cereal in one hand, like pajama pants on, and we'd be like we'd be going like purple in the face.
I can do it.
Yeah. It never worked. I might have got some grays. Anyway, go on.
I think, yeah, so just around that time it was purchasing because, you know, they were always advertising it on their network, of course. And I think it was with, like, Pat and Sugar.
Okay.
Remember that high-pitched lady?
Yeah.
And then Pat, who's now
Sugar Lynn
on...
Sugar Beard.
What?
Sugar Lynn Beard.
Sugar Lynn Beard.
Name. Yeah. I believe she's voice actor now.
All right. Sugar Lynn Beard. Let's go with Sugar. Show me Sugar Lynn Beard.
No, you don't want to see her.
Okay.
She's a cutie. Oh,
my mom despised her voice.
Yeah. Yeah, my mom used to be like,
she doesn't really sound like that.
But I bet your mom doesn't really sound like that either.
Yeah, yeah.
But anyways, so I purchased this CD. I think that was one of the first ones. And there was just all these random, like, offshoot boy bands that, like, picked up by a major label but never really probably put their money into marketing. They just put it into a dope-sounding record.
B-3-3. I think there might have been an S Club tune on the
yeah, definitely S Club.
At that time, were they doing the Nuclear Donkey song?
Yeah, they did the Donkey Sneakers. Remember?
Yeah. So like on YTV's record, they on every iteration they would do this thing. I think on everyone it was just called like the Nuclear Donkey something or other, and it was like the two hosts would do a song together.
Yeah. Donkey Sneakers.
It would kind of like parody like the super popular genre of the year. So like sometimes you get rap, sometimes you get a
like
rock
poppy
rap.
One. Yeah.
Sometimes you just get like a pure pop song.
Yeah.
It was
now you get trapped.
And there would be like, what was there any good, was there any memorable tunes on the record?
S Club one for sure. Yeah. And the Donkey Sneakers one. Yeah, and
yeah. I actually remember listening to like the specifically the Nuclear Donkey tunes more than the rest of the songs on the album.
Today is Friday.
I wonder if you can find that kind of stuff on YouTube.
Oh, guaranteed. You can find like old episodes of The Zone, because I went to go check it out, because I was like, what I basically wanted to check out is like, is Carlos still doing The Zone?
Yes, he is.
And then I looked it up. I was like, he's still doing
and
The Zone.
He has an age.
Yeah, I know. He looks from the Fountain of Youth. It's literally...
they just laminated him and they were like, okay, this is how you
They have him kept in like a hyperbolic time chamber. So he's really going at ultra speed, but they play it in slow motion.
Yeah.
I can't believe you guys remember all that.
Speaking of YTV, do you remember when their website kind of started to like rip off of like Newgrounds? And they started putting up like all these flash animations.
Yeah, and like games and shit. Yeah.
Oh, I used to pop off on YTV.com all the fucking time.
What, like in the comments?
No. So
I would
like wreck the high scores in a ton of their games. They had these things where like it was kind of like a little floating robot, and you could like customize it. Like you would have like a login, and everybody could customize their own little robot, and they would show like different codes during shows. And I would, like, run to my parents' desktop computer that was slow as fucking dirt.
Oh.
And I would, like, have to remember the code in my head. So I would say it when it would show up. No, I never had the forethought to do something like that. So I would see it, and it would be on screen for about 4 or 5 seconds. And I would start just repeating it and running through my house and just saying it over and over and over again. I'm waiting for, like, I don't know, 9 minutes for this desktop to turn on, and I'm still just yelling this code over and over again, so I can finally slap it into YTV.com, and my robot gets like a new pair of like antennas or some ridiculous shit like that.
Fuck. Even back then, they had cheap upgrades, really shitty upgrades.
But you didn't have to pay for them.
Yeah, exactly.
That is true. I wonder how it is now. I wonder if you go on websites now, they're like, get the ultra antennas for
the ultra antennas.
Yeah. News articles.
Oh my god. Those websites.
Five new Carlos animations.
Where it's like,
I just right click,
turn off your ad blocker, and I'm like, I'll turn off your site. I don't care for the news that much.
If you right click and hit inspect.
View page source.
Yeah.
Damn, you boys are on those hotkeys like hot cakes.
Even though you can do that, I just close the website. I don't support that shit at all.
You can also
Oh, that's true. That's true.
Works on the mobile.
Yeah, so I definitely owned like 4 or 5 of the YTV records. I remember one of them had the hamster dance, hamster dance on it.
Oh, my hamsters are damp.
Artist was a Hammy the Hamster, I believe.
Yeah. Should have been Hamtaro.
Yeah.
But
I don't think Hamtaro had like made it to North America. When
it did, yeah. It was on YTV.
No, I know, but was it when that specific YTV album had come out?
That era.
I don't think it was.
No, I don't know.
Big Shiny Tunes.
Much music,
yeah. Big Shiny Tunes. And then now
They're still making them. And there's like Big
now,
Shiny Tunes like 339.
One Big Shiny Tunes for
it's
every
like
day of the year.
It's like Final Fantasy.
Almost.
It just doesn't fucking stop.
They're just like slowly throwing in like their own self-made songs. Check out my mixtape.
Yeah.
It's fire.
Yeah.
Okay, so now that the hot garbage is out of the way, do you guys remember like the first record you picked up or somebody gave to you or whatever, and you kind of like started to think about music in a different way? Like it really piqued a different kind of interest in you?
The Offspring Americana.
Nice.
Americana.
Nice.
I brought it to elementary school in the 3rd grade, and Robin Barker,
he
saw me pull it out of my knapsack. Didn't have a CD player or anything. I just was carrying the CD for some fucking reason. And he saw me pull it out of my bag. Then he tried grabbing it from me, and we got in an argument. And the teacher started yelling at us. And she told me that I could never bring the CD into class again.
I thought it was going to end in like a wholesome story. Like the teacher popped that on. The whole class started clapping for me.
It ended in blasphemy.
Robin Barker would bring this little plastic snare, and he would just sit outside during recess and just beat the piss out of it.
Like just do like rudiments and shit. That's so dope, though.
Fucking crazy.
Yeah.
I wonder what he's up to.
Probably still playing drums.
Snare.
Right,
just playing that one plastic snare.
Yeah, he still. Some say he still plays it to this day.
He's still just sitting outside of the elementary school.
Yeah.
I remember the days.
Children. So, like, what about that record piqued your interest?
I don't know. I think it was just I think it was the album art.
Yeah, for sure. Thing. The Offspring always had some really poppy, cool album art.
Yeah.
And then, obviously, I think Pretty Fly for a White Guy was on there. And how could you not like that song back in the day?
It's true. It's true.
Certified banger.
Yeah.
I remember my dad downloading that song on Napster.
Ooh, badass.
Damn, your dad on Napster?
My dad showed me Napster.
Yeah, my pop showed it to me, and I was like, I don't understand this. And he was like, you can just download music. I'm like, but don't you have to pay for that? And he was like, not anymore. And then, like, a couple months later, like, Metallica brought the lawsuits down, and my dad was like, I should throw this computer out.
Like, it's going to blow up.
I'm like, what do you mean? He's like, I'm afraid I'm going to get arrested.
Yeah.
And he was 100% serious about it.
That was a lot of people, though. That was a lot of people. Oh, yeah. Like, remember when you were a kid doing that? And when you were a kid doing that, you were like, it's going to be like that scene where, you know, the FBI, like, helicopters in and, like, breaks your window and, like,
Using fucking BearShare and Kazaa and LimeWire and all
Azure's, the fucking blue frog one.
All
yeah.
this garbage.
FrostWire was the last nail in the coffin. Yeah.
But they were necessary for what we use as, like, torrents now. Like, that was the original peer-to-peer networking. It just wasn't efficient.
There's watermarks on everything you downloaded.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. It was so brutal.
I loved when you would get, like, a recording that somebody did through, like, a vacuum of, like, a radio station for, like, a song. And you're like, why would you upload this? But it was like weird crossover shit, I guess, from, like, when our parents were younger, you would find, like, a weird dude in town who would give you, like, a bootleg mixtape that would have that kind of shit on it, you know?
Yeah.
And he would, like, give you, like, a catalog. And you could, like, pick songs and he would, like, make you a mixtape or whatever.
Huh.
And then once peer-to-peer sharing became a thing, that same weird trench coat dude was like uploading his crappy bootlegs up on
I gotta make somebody off of this.
I can't think of any off like the top of my head, but there are certain files you would download on LimeWire and it would just be like titled the name of a song, but it was like some other artist.
There was a Nirvana one, and I think they called it Half the Man I Used to Be.
Yeah, that sounds about right. And everybody, you talk to anybody like in our age group now, and they know about that song.
Yeah.
And there was like a couple ones where like the song was actually dope, but there's like no way you'd ever figure out who the artist was.
There was this one that I would always download. It was some song about Zelda or something, and it was labeled as System of a Down.
The Legend of Zelda. It was called The Legend of Zelda or something like that.
I recall that too. Yeah.
It
just
wasn't System of a Down.
Yeah. Those weird little peer-to-peer anomalies.
Yeah, a couple. Well, when we were first starting to set up the podcast, I showed you guys that System of a Down song that's not on any records. And the only reason I had stumbled across it originally was because it just came up on like peer-to-peer services. I didn't have the option of downloading a whole discography in one go. You had to click on every single song.
Yeah, remember the days? I remember the first time you were able to download a discography. That was insane.
That was too much power, man.
Yeah.
I would go through like these bouts where I would download, let's say, Black Sabbath's discography, and that's all I would listen to for a whole year.
Yeah.
Just 1 year of Sabbath.
Really?
Yeah, I swear to God.
I would download discography.
Mr. Crowley. I think that actually is like what kind of, for me, gave that big musical like maturity kind of like tipping point, pivotal point for me, was being able to download discographies, because I was, you know, you had those MP3 players that was maybe like 128 megabytes.
Yes. My parents would only give me the 64 meg.
Yeah, so you could only
like
have like
28
so
songs.
You basically, you're like two CDs worth of songs. You better make it a good fucking mixtape. And then when you're able to just download a whole discography, and then, you know, the iPod started coming out, and then, but it was from that little selection on those small size MP3 players that I was like, now I can get a discography of each of those bands.
You would like pass them off to your friends, and he would like pop in his headphones. You'd like show him a song. You'd be like, it's song number 103. And you'd have to like click next. Like, I had some like RCA thing, and it wasn't like, it was like a calculator screen, basically, and you couldn't just like choose the number you wanted to go to. You had to do it like a CD, basically. You had to go through every fucking song until you got to the one you wanted to listen to.
Yeah.
And I had a catalog in my brain. I knew where every song was at. And
it
was a pain in the ass. But it was like one of the first MP3 players that came around. I begged my parents for it. I think it was only 64 megabytes, and it probably cost $200.
My dad Jeez. Would make, WMA CDs. I think it's another... I think it gets compressed more than an MP3.
Oh, yeah. Really?
So you can fit more onto a CD. There would be so many fucking songs on these CDs.
Is there, like, artifacting on the music? Like, does it lose quality?
Probably severely. It's like 64 kbps. When you hear like that, when you hear like the bits, yeah, you literally hear the bits.
There's like things.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's just remember on like a 9-hour trip to Chicago, I was just listening to one CD the whole time. It was fucking crazy.
Dang. I think my first experience with some music that kind of like piqued my interest in wanting to explore stuff that was like way out of the realm of anything I would be able to listen to, like, I don't know, we only had select radio stations around like KW, and it was kind of, you had like Z103.5 just playing like club bangers and some hip hop like late at night, or you had like 102.1 The Edge, but there wasn't any way for me to explore anything like outside of that, really. Like YouTube wasn't a thing.
Yeah.
My uncle has like a massive CD collection, and for, I want to say it was my 11th birthday, him and my aunt made me my own mixtape. Like, they just picked out all these songs that they thought I would like. And one of the songs on there was Around the World by Daft Punk.
Nice.
And I don't know what it is about that song. Even to this day, like, I could just listen to it over and over and over again. Like, it's such a good groove. But I heard that tune, and I'm like, I need more of this. I don't know what this is. I had to ask my uncle what it was, and he was like, oh yeah, this is Daft Punk. They're crazy. And then I started exploring like some electronic music, like French electronic music like that. And I think that was like the first time I really wanted to get my hands on like some music that like my parents didn't listen to and my friends weren't listening to and that kind of thing. Kind of like being a little hipster about it. It's like, yo, I gotta check this shit out that I found, man. But I was so young at the time.
Like, how old?
Maybe like 11 or 12.
Oh, okay.
And then I remember asking my dad if I could go through like his cassette and CD collection and just like try some stuff out. Because like prior to this age, he was like, don't touch my CDs. Like, you're going to fuck them up or whatever.
You're going to scratch them.
Yeah.
Don't touch the walls either.
Which yeah, don't touch the walls either. Keep your hands in the box. And this is when... Yeah, like Napster was coming around, so like a lot of his music collection was moving to like a purely digital, like virtual storage. And he was like, yeah, I don't know if I'm going to use these CDs again. Like, have at them, like look through them. So I was pulling out stuff like he had Nine Inch Nails' Downward Spiral in there.
And wow, your dad.
Yeah. There's a lot of shit you wouldn't expect my dad to listen to in his Nazareth. Collection. Yeah, definitely some Nazareth in there. That's where I first discovered that there was a version of Red Hot Chili Peppers that existed that wasn't so melancholy and sappy as they were when Californication came out.
Yeah.
He had their self-titled record and the Uplift Mofo Party Plan.
Oh,
which
shit.
Are both two like ridiculously badass punk rap records.
In their infancy.
Yeah. With Hillel Slovak playing on guitar and... Chad Smith wasn't their drummer at the time. Like, it's just a really different sound and something that you wouldn't really get from any other band. And like, I listened to those records and it blew my mind that some dudes were making music like this and they decided to stop making music like that, you know, but
they took it in a pretty sweet
place. For sure. But I didn't understand that when I was like that young. I was just like, why would you stop making music like this?
Yeah.
It took me until I was maybe 14 or 15 when I started like really wanting to learn about the bands that I was listening to discover that they kind of inspired like a huge movement and they were like pioneering a new sound even when they transferred away from that kind of original music that they're making. So listening to stuff like that added like levels and layers to the music. I wasn't just taking a song for its face value. Like, I was beginning to become interested in
the artist making the art.
Artist making the art. And that's when I asked my parents to pick me up like a guitar, my first guitar. And
what kind of guitar did you get?
A Fender Squire.
Damn.
Strat. No, black.
Like my heart.
I still have it, and it's still, to me, the nicest sounding guitar. It's kind of like...
You're biased.
I don't think I'm biased. I think I've just worked it in this type of way that sounds really nice to me. And like, I you learn like the characteristics of your instrument, you know?
You learn how to feel.
Yeah, like I could go pick up one of those things and it would feel like really rigid and weird to me, where you would go pick it up and you'd feel super comfortable.
I have a similar Strat model.
That Silver Boy?
No, it's the it's one of my first ones over there, like my very first one, but it's got no strings, but it's like Strat, like Squire Strat, but it's not a Strat. It's a Behringer.
Oh, okay.
Like even the cheaper model, but still does the job.
How many guitars have you had since that Squire?
So I've just had that Squire. I've borrowed hundreds of guitars
You're
from people.
That Squire this
yeah, that's
time.
That's all I've ever used.
Holy fuck. Jeez.
How dirty is that fretboard?
Oh, it's nasty. This thing is beaten up. But I can't, like, I'll borrow other guitars and I try other guitars and I'm just like, I go back to this shit sound because there's something about it that just like has a characteristic that I can't find.
It's got that mojo, baby.
Yeah, it's got something special. And people always make fun of me for it, and they'd like come over and look at my guitar and they'd be like, that's a nasty fucking thing. You're working, why don't you buy something nice? And I discovered that Jack White actually play, or his favorite guitar is a plastic guitar he picked up from Toys R Us when he was young as well.
That's so weird.
And he was just
like,
there's like this sound to it that you can't get anywhere else. Like it's pretty unique. And I always question it, but I don't know. There's just something about it that I love.
That's cool.
Yeah.
I love that.
Yeah,
I love that.
Yeah. And you look at the guitar and you'd be like, oh, that's Christian's guitar. Like, it's just beat up in this kind of way. Like, there's, like, carvings and shit in it from over the years. Like, stickers that have rotted away on the thing. Like, it's just, it's seen a lot.
That's cool. I feel like there's, like, those two different kinds of guitar, like, the instrument. People who like the instrument themselves, mm-hmm. like, those kind of people. Because mm-hmm. there's people like yourself who, you know, like, has the one guitar and it's just that guitar means something to them. And, you know, those guitarists in a more like famous kind of aspect have always had that same like signature model forever.
Yeah, sure.
But then there's like other guitarists who just like are always collecting guitars and they're always, you know, they're like, they're almost like watch collectors. It's about like the craftsmanship
for sure,
of like how delicate everything
I think
is.
Part of it,
but it's kind
of
cool that, you know,
I think part of it is like, I'm not a super technical player. I don't know a ton of theory, but I have a good ear. So like, I know how to work that instrument to fit me, you know, where I pick up another guitar and like it's not gonna work the same. I can't work it as quickly. I can't do techniques that I've developed in my own head and like in my own practice. You know what I mean?
Well, it's also cool because like that guitar not only is just comfortable for you, but you can rely on it to like bring out ideas.
Yeah, exactly.
That's really cool.
Exactly.
Is there a reason why you didn't get into the music theory aspect of things?
I started taking guitar lessons and my teacher was like,
tabs?
No, he was like,
you learned all to make
basically, he was like, you have two options. We can get deep into theory or you can learn to shred and you'll get pussy.
Jeez.
And I'm like 12 or 13 and I'm like, let's shred. He literally taught me to read tabs and I was like, oh, that's it. Like this is all you need to know to like read music. And I was so like naive at the time.
Yeah.
So then I just stopped taking lessons. I was like, okay, now I know how to read a tab. So like, I'll go do my own thing.
Yeah.
But then,
yeah,
but I was never somebody who was fulfilled playing other people's music. Like it was fun to like play a riff or something from a song, but it didn't give me any satisfaction. I wasn't the kind of guy who was going to go in front of like the school and play like covers for them and like everyone's gonna geek out because you can play like some Sum 41 or Blink 182 or whatever. Like it was fun to see how those players played, but like it just wasn't for me. So I would just sit there and like tool away for hours and hours just writing like riffs and licks that sounded horrible until
Jesus.
Wow, that's exciting.
Yeah, maybe. Wow. Next time buy some better stands.
That just happened.
That's I used to be obsessed with learning other musicians' songs and shit. It's all I would focus on. And then after this one terrible August Burns Red concert.
That's the one that changed music for you forever.
Yeah.
Oh, what happened?
Dude, it was just a...
They just bomb, or?
Yeah, I guess. And it's just a very strange environment. I was not in the right state of mind.
Okay.
And I was just noticing a lot of shitty things.
Interesting.
And then it just, the night just kept getting worse and worse and worse. And then it got to the point where I'm just standing there watching my band. I'm like, this is, I don't want to be a part of this anymore.
Wow, that's wild.
Yeah,
that's
and it's wild. Crazy because
and then I just like stopped opening Guitar Pro.
Yeah.
All of that shit. And then I just like tried going off and figuring out guitar in a totally different way. Just fucking, it was hard.
That, yeah, that was a, yeah, it must have been like a, you know, like an ego loss, you know, almost
yeah, sure.
with like your music identity. Yeah.
It's a strange path to go down, but.
Do you think it's a rewarding one or?
It's, if you stick to
it. Is it a kind of take it or leave it kind of situation?
I don't know. At the time, I was just like really questioning everything. I'm like, do I even want to play guitar anymore?
Mm-hmm.
That show really fucked me up.
Yeah. And it's weird because you were the guy that got me into metal. Like that was my, I guess this is time for like my portion of the story, but you know, like my breakthrough kind of pivotal musical moment was getting into like really heavy music. Like I got into bands like Tool and like Nine Inch Nails and stuff that kind of like got me from like the pop punk kind of angsty teen side to like the more like edgier, like, you know, kind of like society is doomed, like kind of
just nihilistic.
You know,
yeah,
exactly.
Yeah, okay.
And then, you know, especially when you're 16,
everything's
listening to
black
that.
And death.
Yeah. Which then slips into the kind of scene kind of phase with metal, and you were getting me into that. And I remember we used to always like drive around in your car at high school, and you were just always blasting like Bring Me the Horizon, like back in like the Pray for Plagues days.
Yeah,
August Burns Red.
Yeah, when they were actually sick.
Yeah. Parkway Drive. All those bands. And I remember you were just blasting them, and I was like, I don't listen to this. But then it's like, I feel like when you get into like, I feel like those pivotal moments of when you start to like understand a certain kind of music and start really wanting to like, you're addicted to getting to know it better. That like style is you just are listening to some artist at a certain time, at a certain place. It's out of your control. And then it just clicks. And then you just,
that's,
I don't
so
know, it just kind of happens.
Like, I always, ever since I met you, like metal like that was just like quintessential to who you were. And it's funny to have only met PK like a couple months ago, and now I'm finding out that he's like the reason.
Oh yeah, he's, yeah, he is the reason. And then we went to that concert together, that August Burns Red concert.
Yeah.
And I remember just on
did
the way home
together
we did,
was he just in silence?
Oh, we were, because like we were, I remember we were driving home and it was just, you know, like kind of whatever, like, oh, we should stop somewhere to eat, oh, blah, blah, then, you know, just kind of rolling, and then, you know what, I don't know how I feel about that show. And then it was just like, what do you mean? Because, well, because like some people, you know, you get that post-show kind of high, even if you're a listener or a performer. It's like,
that was the best show.
And then
I love this fucking band.
Exactly.
That's how I was going into it. I'm like, this is going to be
best.
And it was cool because remember, Architects happened to be a surprise opener. So it was like, it was fucking lit. Mm. Everyone's enjoying the time. And then they came on, and I think it was... Yeah, I don't know what happened, but I think some people were kind of talking about like, oh yeah, the show was sick. Remember when they did this or this? And then you're just kind of like, you know, I don't know. Because I remember
you know
one.
It's funny. Yeah. That show, I had a ticket for it, and I just decided not to go.
Could have ended up the same way as I did.
I did, and I didn't even have to be there. I can't even listen to August Burns Red anymore. Like, there's a whole like little section of metal like that where I'm just like,
yeah,
it's so aggressive and like kind of promotes,
but they're Christian,
it fuck off promotes like this
looking
crowd
at you as they're dying,
or promotes these fans that I'm just like, I don't know if I want to associate with these people, like they're kind of dickheads, you know.
I think it's just looking at the negative parts of like the scene. Like that's kind of every scene. There's always like a, there's always this shitty snobby, not even snobby, just kind of like the douches of the, yeah, the pretentious ones or something like that.
I guess I'm the pretentious one for not wanting to
associate. No, please. I don't mean that. I mean, I just kind of mean that there's always those kind of people to like nitpick out of the crowd because they kind of ruin it for everybody. Like people, and I think there's different people in each scene for that. Like, for example, for me, it's like, I get it. Like metal shows, like moshing is part of that. But sometimes it's just, you know, sometimes it's just like, all right, dude, like we don't have
to
mosh during
moshing,
the ballad.
There's moshing. And then there's like,
yeah,
just
like if I get too close, you're going to fucking knock me out.
Yeah,
dude. Yeah. Like moshing's supposed to be a harmonious bonding experience for an audience. Like, it's okay if you get like chucked to the floor, somebody's gonna pull you up. But there's been like, I went to go see like Exalt at the Wax,
yeah,
and like the crowd was like trying to kill people.
Yeah. But some shows like that are crazy, like the Every Time I Die show I showed you. Yeah, at the Wax. Anyway, sorry, go on.
I don't know what it is about the Wax. It brings out the the best in people.
It's those pillars in the middle of the crowd. They're like, someone's going to run into this pole and fucking die.
When I went to see Death From Above there,
Damn.
It was the coolest fucking show. Like, I never thought I would get the chance to see a band like that that I had idolized for so long play in such a tight and, like, romantic venue. You know,
that's cool.
I was always like, if I go see them, I'm gonna have to go to Toronto. It's gonna be a bigger like Sound Academy or whatever.
Phoenix.
To see them at the Wax and be like, you're packed in there right with the band.
Yeah,
like, damn, this is cool.
How many albums did they release at that point? It was just You're a Woman, I'm a Machine.
This was for their comeback, or right before their comeback.
Like the most recent one.
Yes.
Oh,
I
damn.
I went to London to see them.
Okay.
It's like some fucked up winter storm, like trudging through the snow to get to the fucking venue, but it was sick. They're surprisingly very good vibes.
Amazing. So
never
tight.
Saw them. I wish I
so tight.
Actually, You're a Woman, I'm a Machine was the first album that I bought with my own money, because I remember watching Blood on Our Hands.
Is that the pink CD?
Yeah, with the elephant. Yeah, because they had one before that, like an early EP, which was like an orange cover.
Yeah,
and they had like short hair. And yeah.
Those records, I actually never purchased them. I went to the Kitchener Public Library, the off branch in St. Mary's High School.
Jeez.
And I rented those albums so I could rip them onto my computer.
Nice.
And I only picked them up because I liked the album covers. I didn't know who Death From Above was. Like, I'm sure some of their tunes had gotten played on The Edge, but I probably didn't pay much mind because, you know, The Edge has been like on a pretty crappy downtrend for a while. I stopped taking them seriously when they cut Alan Cross's programming.
That was a little maybe a couple years back.
Yeah, years back. I borrowed the records and then ripped them and put them onto that garbage MP3 player probably. And yeah, that was my like first experience with DFA. And to this day they're still like one of my favorite bands.
Yeah, they got
those
that energy. Yeah.
Listen to their new stuff.
Mm-hmm. Super different. I'm okay with it.
The mixing is so fucking different.
Yeah. They actually just dropped all the demos from You're a Woman, I'm a Machine last week. I forgot the
Really? Oh, damn.
Yeah, it's on Spotify.
Huh.
I'm going to download that right now.
Yeah, it's cool. The vocals are really deep in the mix, like really quiet. So it's essentially like sounds like a live performance.
Oh, definitely. Probably just like, you know, like a jam hall or something
hall,
where they just multi-track
just
recorded it for
a
couple channels, maybe like a couple drum mics only.
Yeah,
it's cool. And they're such, it's so cool how like they provide such like a crazy energy and they're a two-piece band. Like
Oh, is that what it is? Okay. So after you guys kind of got like, so you had the Offspring, you had
just kind of the whole metalcore movement as it was happening. Like I kind of just like threw myself in that like inertia of that. Yeah.
And that's kind of been like the past decade or so past.
Yeah. I kind of went with the motions of like what trends kind of became more, you know, prevalent, stuff like that. But
okay.
Yeah.
Offspring was like third grade for me. And then I started getting into Nirvana and then got really into System of a Down. Grade six or seven. I started listening to them. And like their music just fucking blew my mind.
Yeah, me as well. I was right in the same age range.
I was such a fan of them, man. I was constantly playing them on my CD player. It's fucked.
My dad and uncle would bully me for listening to System of a Down. Like I would have my headphones in and they could hear like Serge singing and we'd be like, I don't know, going to like the family Christmas or whatever and I'm just listening to my iPod blasting System of a Down. And my dad and uncle are like, what? Angels die.
Yo, can I interrupt with an anecdote, though?
Yeah.
It reminds me because my cousin was driving me from my house to his house in Toronto for Christmas. And I was listening to Blink-182 in my Walkman. And he puts in Tool. This was kind of before I started getting into metal. And I just, because he put on like Eulogy with like the and then I was like, what's this? And he just goes, this is real music. and then that was pretty much it. But anyways,
that's hilarious.
Yeah.
Well, did you think it was real music?
Oh yeah, that's when I pretty much got like obsessed with Tool in high school, and then after that was kind of metal. But it was like strictly Tool for like 2 years, and then it was like,
yeah. Yeah. I didn't start getting into like Tool and tunes like that until I started smoking a lot of pot, and I was just like, I need something to just melt my brain, like Meshuggah and Tool and shit like that. And like this is when like Adam Reinhardt and I would be like sharing a lot of music back and forth.
Nice.
So like I'd discover something weird, he would discover something weird, we'd swap them. It was just like a lot of really bad music, but a lot of really dope music too.
I didn't start listening to Tool until like after high school.
Interesting.
Yeah.
With Tool kind of came everything, like Deftones, Nine Inch Nails, like that whole 90s alt scene, and even like the kind of weird like electric stuff like Skinny Puppy and like stuff like that. If you kind of remember, they were doing a bunch of like remixes of like theirs, kind of a
Skinny Puppy CD in my fucking work truck at John's Nursery.
Oh, it's so weird.
Yeah.
This,
I don't know. He's like such a weird dude. You can't talk to him about anything. He just stands there and just scratches himself and just respond to things properly.
What?
It always makes you so uncomfortable, and then he just walks away. And you're like,
what the hell?
Nice.
That guy's got some bodies.
Yeah, that guy. Yeah,
that's sure, insane. That's insane.
Yeah.
Yeah, for me, System of a Down was like huge turning point, grade 7, grade 8, for when shimmy. I started to, shimmy. I used to listen to Cigarro. All the time. Like, I was just like, this is the heaviest thing I ever heard. These lyrics are weird as fuck, but this is the heaviest shit I've ever heard in my life. And then that's kind of started to branch off. I started to get into like some thrash metal, but I started with like quintessential thrash. Like, I went back to like listen to Slayer all the time, and then I moved forward to like Lamb of God and started getting into like some new thrash kind of bands.
I got made fun of in my grade 9 music class by no names. And he was making fun of me for listening to Nirvana and System of a Down and shit. And then
what was he listening to?
He's the guy who got me into Under Oath. Like, all of this.
Well, it makes sense why he would make fun of you, but I get
all
it.
All of this different like metal. And I just abandoned all that other shit and just started getting into Under Oath and all that fun stuff.
Under Oath never really took for me, specifically.
Unbelievable.
Because the first thing I saw was Christian metal band, and I went,
those two don't mix.
Even though no, even though we were at like Catholic school and shit, I'm like, yo, fuck all that shit, fuck religion, that shit makes no sense. I believe in microbiology.
I believe in myself.
And I was like,
man.
And I even knew that like Under Oath and August Burns Red and like the dozens of other Christian metal bands that were actually pretty banging didn't really have that much religious content in their lyrics. I just like refused. I like protested. Like, I'm not going to listen to this. I don't care what they sing about or like how hard they are. I'm just not listening to it.
I saw Under Oath in grade 7 at a Taste of Chaos concert with The Used and My Chemical Romance and Killswitch Engage.
Wow, that's a dirty lineup. Yeah, Jesus.
I just had no idea that I actually saw Under Oath. Then he brought it up in grade 9. I'm like, holy fuck.
That's kind of funny. I had that happen with a band as well recently. I went to go see Streetlight Manifesto perform.
Hey, that's pretty sweet.
And this was, I want to say, maybe 5 years ago or so. And they had, what's that group? Shit.
Feel fresh in the memory.
Okay, so they're from Toronto, I believe, and they have a female vocalist and then a male vocalist, and the male vocalist sounds like Oscar the Grouch. You would have heard him on the radio.
Oh,
my guns and ammunition.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, I know what you're
like. That's what he sounds like. Shit, I think they have a month in their name or a day of the week.
Dallas Green.
No, it's not Dallas. It'll come to me. Anyway, they're massive now. And at the time, they opened for Streetlight and performed like kind of like a couple like duets with Streetlight Manifesto. And I was like, dang, this guy's voice is annoying.
Didn't work. Well.
And then, maybe a year or two later, I heard the voice on the radio. And I'm like, no, I still don't like their music. But, July Talk. July
Talk.
Yeah, I was like, I still don't like their music, and it's kind of weird that I saw them perform. But they were just nobody. I don't even know if they went by July Talk at the time. Or
yeah, maybe they were known as Talking July.
I remember just, I was there with, I think, my buddy Kurt, and I'm just looking at him and going, does that guy sound like a salty sea captain to you?
Yar, from fucking Simpsons.
Yar.
Fisherman's friend, boy.
Yeah.
I can't imagine that working well with Street Light Manifesto.
Well, unbeknownst to me, I had bought tickets for an acoustic Streetlight Manifesto show.
So you're expecting the whole big band thing?
I'm pretty sure it was sold as just Streetlight Manifesto, and something might have happened where like the rest of the band couldn't show up.
Was it just acoustic guitars?
It was Toki, like their lead singer, and the drummer was there, and a bass player, and I think that was it. Like there was like no horn section or anything.
Wow, that must have sounded different.
It was super different. And I was the driver, so I couldn't drink enough to get into it. And I've never been a huge fan of acoustic sets.
Well, I'll never listen to this band again.
I held it in because the other people I went with loved it. Like, they're totally down with that kind of shit. But I went in expecting to, like, skank around and, like, listen to some fucking ska for the night. And
for sure.
It just wasn't that. And I don't mean to knock on acoustic shows. They're pretty cool.
Knock on
like
them all you want, man.
Alice in Chains Unplugged is fucking wild, and Nirvana's Unplugged set is pretty wild as well.
Yeah. I'm going to be going to see the Contortionist Thursday, and they're doing a 2-hour set, which one they're just kind of doing their regular catalog, and then afterwards, or maybe even before, they're going to do like a whole redone like soft kind of acoustic chill set of like yeah, of course. I'll be like, hey, I know you guys have to do a tour, but can you just detour an hour?
How many times have you seen the Contortionist now?
Oh, man, so probably like the third or fourth time. All right,
so you can use that as your ace. I've seen you guys 4 times.
You owe me.
I basically paid for your hotel.
You can sleep on my couch.
I know you guys only earned like a percentage.
Not my parents' couch. I have this nasty couch in this studio that I got.
Yeah.
You guys are all going to sleep on it. But yeah, seen them a few times. They've evolved huge since like the first time I saw them when they were like tech death band kind of, a few core elements, and then they got a new vocalist and they really chilled out, and you know they kind of went like slightly more like of a more like rock kind of vibe.
Yeah,
and with the metal still, but then now this new album is just totally
cool,
chilled out. So it's gonna be cool to see what they can provide in terms of like putting that sort of new mindset aesthetic on their old songs, which are I want to know if they'll pull that out because they said they're doing like a reimagined set, so I don't know if that means like songs that they have just recently put out or if that's going to be like more widespread in their repertoire.
So I think we're all kind of sitting around like maybe grade 9, grade 10, grade 8 with our where we're at.
Yeah,
musical story,
I would say.
So do you guys just want to go from like how did you go from there to where we are now? I think that's a pretty logical jump. Like was there any big defining bands or sounds?
I think it was just kind of get, you know, the more, because when you're younger and you're getting into like this music that you kind of only listen to, it's because you got a lot of energy, and I think that kind of plays out in what kind of music you're into, like metal or you know, just like high energy like band music. And then I think as I got older and I started getting more like the production aspect of things, I was kind of just more interested in like discovering like different like textures, like sound wise. And I think the kind of whole thing of being into like, you know, maybe even like Nine Inch Nails and like those kind of that kind of stuff kind of played into that, because then I started having more of an open mind towards electronic music, because whereas before I was just like, it all sounds the same, blah, 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 blah. And then, it, you know, because that's when you're not into a genre, and then kind of going back to what I said about having that one moment that it just clicks for you.
Yeah.
And it's out of your control when or where that's going to be, and it just happens. You're listening to a song, and you're like, I get it. And then that's when your kind of self-discovery of that's happened. So it's kind of been like that more with just, because I've always kind of been into like hip-hop music.
Yeah.
But I guess it's more now that, you know, hip-hop and pop are kind of like meeting at their ends again.
Yeah.
Because
yeah.
before, you know, like 4 years ago, the whole pop wave was kind of built around
crescendo.
Well, it was built around more of like the EDM kind of like style, whereas now it's kind of in more hip hop with like the backbeat, I guess. Sure. So now that's kind of giving me a more open mind to like mainstream music. Mm-hmm. And pretty much just, I don't know, I guess just over the course of from high school until now, the self-discovery I've kind of met with myself is that I've pretty much just kind of had more of an open mind towards everything. Thanks to getting into production, because it kind of just lets you understand like what makes a good song rather than like, the, you know, all these like image based things behind the music, so to say. It's not like the image of the band. It's just like
it's like you almost take a step inside the artist's mind.
Yeah.
Or inside the song, and you see it from the inside out as opposed to looking at it from the outside in.
You have more empathy for the music.
You get affected by how this artist portrays himself publicly, or like just all the shit that really shouldn't cloud your judgment on
which
music.
It used to huge. Like I'd be like, oh, why are they dressed like that? Why are they? And then I'm thinking about it now. It's like I don't fucking care what they do. Like you can't
the artist
you can't associate.
I have no clue what they look.
Yeah, you can't associate the art with the artist. Like I know I'm going off of like music, but imagine you were living in like Van Gogh's time, mm-hmm. or imagine if like Van Gogh. I think it's some sort of steak, some sort of cheese. No,
anyways, she a stripper.
Imagine being in Van Gogh's time and then just hearing kind of like, oh, did you hear in the news today? Van Gogh cut off his ear. You're like, yeah, I'd probably expect him to do that, but he still makes great art, but he's fucking weird for cutting off his fucking ear. What the fuck? You think anybody's being there being like, what a brave move. Like, no, I just can imagine like the collective mindset would kind of be like perturbed by that. So I think that kind of translates now in a more like tame way with like what artists say and stuff like that, or like how they dress, or like the kind of behaviors they have. But I've kind of learned not to associate myself, because it's just kind of been the test of time. It's just like you shouldn't associate that.
Yeah, for me, it's fun to get in and hash on an artist and just like rip them apart.
Yeah,
but I'll still listen to the tunes.
Yeah,
not about Tekashi. I'm not a fan of his music, but that's like
maybe you should go to jail and find out if
that
you
is the hip hop adjacent pop rap that I'm just not interested in. It's not saying anything I want
to
listen
to. It's crazy because like when I think about someone like Tekashi 6ix9ine, like I don't listen to him at all. Mm-hmm. I couldn't really even name like one of his I couldn't really name one of his lyrics, but when I look at like his view count, it's so high that it's running up against all the top runners, and you're like, I never hear this on the radio or anything, or maybe I just don't pay enough attention to it. But I know what his voice sounds like. He's got a very, you know,
yeah,
his voice stands out in today's music. It's very like aggressive. It's kind of
Me, it's just like I'm pretty far removed from a lot of mainstream stuff. Like if I want to see some mainstream stuff, which on a Friday night I want to have a good laugh, I'll go to YouTube and I'll type, or I'll go to like the trending page and just look at it, and I'm like, I don't know what any of this is, and I just start watching it and I'm like, oh, Tekashi, whoa, this is wild. This kid looks nuts, and this music sucks. And then I just go back into, like, my recesses, like, my world where I control the media that comes in.
Yeah.
And I think it just comes from being a poor person. I can't afford cable. I don't really listen to, like, the radio while I drive around and stuff. So, like, I'm not influenced by a lot of mainstream music, and it has no way of reaching me.
Yeah, I don't know what it was about. Like, it's not that I'm like gonna, you know, go in my car and turn on like the local, you know, like Virgin radio station. But more like I understand. Yeah, I'm always popping the beat. You know, me support local radio. You know, but
I'd rather listen to the college station.
No, definitely. Or no, because like, well, pretty much the main station I have on my car is just Jazz Radio 91.1. Mm-hmm. Just pretty much has have that, because it's perfect for every situation, especially when it's raining. It's just like playing smooth jazz in the rain is just who knows, maybe we're living in my coma fantasy right now.
You know how I get around all this? The day I bought my car, Ryan Gesso gifted me NWA's Straight Outta Compton.
Nice.
And I popped it in my CD player and it hasn't been out. So like if I say I'm in some area where my data runs out and I can't be running my Spotify anymore, I just switch to that CD. And it's driving Lauren. It will drive her insane. She'll be like, I can't listen to this. I'm like, why not? She was like, it's the 8,000th time.
I know. That's me with CDs in my car. And people will be like, oh, is this CD that you've had on many times before? I'm like, yeah, I just have like basically 20 CDs and I just cycle them all just constantly.
Are they all in like horrible disarray? Like you pull it and you're like, this boy ain't working.
Or you pull them in and then you have like 3 CDs in one case. You're like trying to stuff it in there, trying to let it close.
Like sliding around.
Yeah, exactly.
Spotify changed my fucking life.
Yeah, me too. I feel like I am okay with it in some sense, but it also upsets me because I used to hold like this library of music on my hard drive that was just massive, and like I had stuff that you can't find anymore as far as I know. Like, I'd have to go on a very specific forum to ask for somebody to pull a copy of certain tunes out for me. So I lost a lot of that migrating over to Spotify, and just even artists that I've forgotten the names of, but they would like come up on Shuffle and stuff like that. I feel like there's some art lost in collecting music.
But you also
definitely but it's music
at hand. I do discover a ton of music because of Spotify. That's why it's like a double-edged sword for me.
Kind of an oversaturation at points.
There's definitely points where I have to just take a step back from checking out my Discover and my release radar and just go, I should listen to what I have here, because there's albums that I know I went, wow, this album's great, but I've only listened to it one time and now it's a year and a half old and I haven't returned to it. So like often I'll just click like my songs and I'll scroll back to like, I don't know, maybe a year back, and I'm like, oh wow, I've totally forgot about this one, and I start listening to it, and you like rediscover artists within your own library.
Like the Vince Staples album that came out, been so much that's been released after it.
You still listening to it?
I'd like to, but no.
Oh, I listen to it at the gym like every day. Really? It goes so fucking hard.
Really?
Hell yeah.
Like, I feel like I need to keep up with all the releases that are coming out. I'm like, oh, this is fucking sick. This is the taste for the week.
Yeah. I'm really bad for it, especially like hip hop is a genre where it's just like churning out stuff so often.
Because
like, you can be one guy. You can be one guy and make a record in like a month or two, right?
Mm-hmm.
You can produce all your own beats. You have a mic. You just rap into it. Like, it's pretty easy, but has a high skill ceiling. So for that reason, you'll see every single Friday, 10, 11, 12 new records coming out, and I have to choose. Even if there's, I want to listen to every single one, I have to pick and choose because it's just too much music to go through, and there's stuff that gets lost in the turnstile, you know, like the next week hits and I haven't listened to everything that came out the previous week, and I'm like, well, sorry guys,
you
six
lost
albums
me.
Some of it go by the wayside.
Some of it doesn't sound that different from another project.
Mm-hmm.
It's like it's all got the same kind of sound to it. Gets kind of boring after a while.
Oh, totally. There's a lot of artists that I keep my eye on, and then there's ones that I hear being hyped up by the industry, and I go like, I'll listen to like a couple songs, and if it sounds just like everything, like the Migos solo projects is a big example of
Migos.
That. Big example for that for me.
Hunter Stew.
Where like, Offset puts out his project, and it sounds just like the Migos, except it's missing the other two members.
Exactly.
Like, this is just a worse form of what you guys were already doing, which isn't that appealing to me. I'm just going to... I can't knock that.
And even kind of going back to Vince Staples, like, that's a good example of, like, branching out from your supergroup and just everybody sounding totally different, and you can kind of see how,
Vince Staples is not part of Odd Future.
What?
He's just Odd Future adjacent.
I don't think Tyler wanted him in it.
Well, the more I know,
because
I did. Okay.
Yeah.
D-I-L?
No, he's just Odd Future adjacent. He was always hanging around Earl and Tyler.
Oh, okay. Because they had some songs featuring him, so I always thought he was kind of.
Yeah, I think Tyler got mad at Earl for bringing him around very often.
I could see that because, as far as I understand, most of OF is not straight edge, but they're not involved with gangs and shit, where Vince Staples was involved with the Crips. So.
Yeah, he went hard in the paint.
Yeah, so I could see why Tyler probably wouldn't want him hanging around.
It's like, we want to say crazy profanities that really offend people, but we don't want to be involved.
Well,
in any,
he's building a brand, right?
No, it totally worked, and even in juxtaposition with the whole movement of like political correctness, and like it's just crazy how he managed.
It was
they
perfect
managed,
timing too.
It was
like, if that
shit
came out now.
So do you
think
they
would get stricken down to the ground?
Yeah, they came out like kind of right before it became a little bit more taboo and profane.
Just at the tail end of like the mixtape era where everyone's uploading to Dap Piff and World Star Hip Hop.
Oh god.
It's just a mixtape website. Oh. It's like Audio Mac or anything like that.
MP3.com.
Yeah.
Shout out to MP3.com.
Yeah. If it came out any later than that, I don't think you any of those members would be as successful as they are now.
Wouldn't be too small, and that's for sure.
Yeah. So, like, how did you guys... I know we all listen to, like, a lot of hip-hop now.
Yeah.
What kind of, like, sparked that for you guys?
For me, it was grade 5 at Adrian's house.
Adrian Wojcik?
Yeah.
Sorry, I shouldn't be name-dropping, but...
Everybody's just, like, fucking... His parents and everybody's just smoking weed and smoking cigarettes in the house. And then
hell yeah.
Under
the influence comes on by Eminem.
Perfect.
During grade 5, hearing that for the first time, you're like, Jesus fucking Christ, yeah. What is he saying on this album? And then I went home and I downloaded the shit out of it, and that's just like where I began my journey of hip-hop, and I don't know, there's I guess Notorious kind of brought some stuff out for me, and then I just went on this weird rampage of just trying to find better hip-hop.
Yeah. Okay. What about you?
It was YTV's Big Porn Party Mix. No, I'm just kidding. Okay. I'm just kidding. It was
when Sugar busted those hot rhymes.
Yeah, when Sugar put down those bars, those sweet sugary bars. Yeah, sugar bars. And anyways, but it was I think it was kind of like Eminem. I think I remember my brother or myself going to HMV and buying Encore by Eminem.
Nice.
Yeah, and then no, that is the one with... Is it the one with "Ass Like That" on it?
I was never a big...
No, it's the one with, like, Mockingbird and stuff like that. That kind of... That weird, like... Yeah.
Is that Sad Boy shit?
It was... Remember, like, Mockingbird?
Come on,
remember the song?
Everyone get upset.
Haley, I know you miss your mom, and I know you miss your dad.
Use a way too many napkins.
Oh, God. But, I think it was just Eminem and 50 Cent and Get Rich or Die Trying. I remember my brother had a burnt CD in one of those booklets.
Yeah.
And it just said 50 Cent, Get Rich or Die Trying, and, you know, never really watched it on much music. And then when I kind of, you know, heard, like, In the Club and, like, it's just those hard beats. But listening to it on shitty iPod headphones, so you're not hearing any bass, and it's just, blowing them. And
did you actually like 50 Cent?
At the time, I think, but I was, that was even... probably before I even started getting into like heavy music like Tool and stuff, it was that stuff. It was just because I was just kind of getting whatever was in like the house or I don't know, whatever I could get away with. Like I remember even like initially, like we were on the way to like camp one time with my family and they had like a Shakira CD and I just put that shit into my Walkman and started listening to it. I listened to it for like 2 days straight.
Speaking of grabbing random music that's just sitting in your vehicle, my parents had a Shaggy tape,
nice.
A Shaggy cassette. Yeah, and I used to play it all the fucking time. And yeah, that's just some weird shit.
He recently released a CD with Sting. It's fucking weird as shit. He still sounds.
Shaggy's always coming up on my release radar. I don't know why.
Did you see the album that he made with Sting?
No, I don't want to.
Yeah, you do.
I think you do. It's great.
Yeah, so like 50 Cent, I listened to 50 Cent, but I always just felt weird about it because I didn't relate to gangster rap at all. Like it just, I was like, I'm a white kid, I'm like 17, how am I, I can't listen to this, like I can't play this in front of any of my friends, they're just going to like laugh at me or whatever. I remember playing, I'm not into club. Specifically Into Club, I remember playing it on my computer. I got the speakers cranked up. I'm like, dang, these beats really knock.
Yeah,
these beats really knock because Dr. Dre knows exactly what's up. And my parents were like getting ready to go to some party. It was like maybe a Halloween party or something. And the line comes in, something, let the motherfucker burn.
Yeah,
it's like some line in Into Club. And my mom's like, what did he just say? And I said, I don't know. And she's like, I think he said motherfucker. And my dad's like, did he say motherfucker? And
you're like, no, he said mother. He said mother.
I don't know. And they're like, well, what the fuck are you listening to? I'm like, you just said fuck. Like, doesn't matter. We could say what we want.
We're your parents.
You can't listen to this shit. And then I scrubbed all gangster rap from my hard drive for like a long time, because I was like, really scared the shit out of you. I was like, well, I don't want to get yelled at for music I want to listen to, so it's just easier to get rid of it.
That's when the YTV Big Fun Party Mix came out.
So hip hop didn't really. Hip hop didn't look really get reintroduced to myself to me for like a fairly long time, like maybe 4 or 5 years after that, because I would just hear like what they played on the radio. I'm like, all sounds the same. Like, I don't get it. Money, bitches.
I never was really like attached
Let's
to lyrics.
Get poetic.
Yeah.
I guess maybe that's
why I let it slide. Anyways, yeah.
For me, it was like I was used to listening to a lot of other music where the lyricist was like truly being poetic, like,
yeah,
they're writing meaningful lyrics that like touched me, and I'm like, wow, that's really cool. And then you listen to like gangster rap,
yeah,
that's getting played on the radio, and you're just like, oh my god,
yeah,
like it's so vapid, like it means nothing.
No, that was a weird era too, because like considering like gangster rap was around before then, and
yeah,
the kind of like culture of the lyrics was like, you know,
it got turned into like a caricature of what it used to be.
Kind of. I kind of see it more of like a story arc. You know what I kind of mean? It's like you see the beginning and it's like, we're struggling, you know, like shit's fucked up. Hey, people, listen to us. Like, things are going on right now. And then when the 50 Cent kind of G-Unit era took on, it was like, okay, we're in a good spot right now. We're making a lot of money. You know what? I have no shame in showing this off. Like, I want to show you guys like where I'm at right now with like, you know, what I've earned from like this struggle. And then now it's like past that. It doesn't even need to like, you know, I kind of know what I mean. Like before it was talking about more of the struggle, then kind of after, and like the G-Unit era was kind of more talking about like, I struggled, now look where I'm at. And then now it's kind of not even about the struggle. It's just kind of like this. Yeah. Look at all the shit I got. And like, there's a little bit more depth to it depending on the subgenre, but I guess that's like the beauty of the subgenre.
Hold up. Apparently we should turn up PK's mic.
Alright.
Oh. Damn, boy.
I got a news bulletin, a news flash.
Well, thanks, guy. Is this better?
We'll find out. It looks better over there.
Thanks, guy.
I'm lost. I lost the train of thought.
I was just talking about the whole gangster rap, because you were saying it's, you know, it was kind of a caricature of itself, and then I was saying it was kind of like a story arc.
Yeah.
In terms of the collective mindset, because that was a, you know, that was a genre we saw that came out of nothing. You know,
yeah,
we've
been around for the whole.
Well,
most
I mean,
of.
Most of. We were born in the early 90s. We were, you know, we could barely even like understand.
We missed the Grandmaster and all that.
Yeah, we missed all that stuff. The kind of more PG. Like hip hop era.
Yeah, yeah.
In order for it to get to the mainstream, but I mean, hip hop is kind of, I don't know. It's just, it's such a huge, huge genre now that I think just the kind of like lyrical content in it is, you can take so much from it, but from the origins of where it was, like it's, yeah, it was hard to relate to. It was hard to relate to like being younger.
Yeah.
And just like the lyricism of like gangster rap and what it was like, although it was like, yeah, you know, call it what you will, but it was, yeah, it was definitely hard to relate to it.
Right, right, for sure.
Mac Miller definitely brought some nice shit from like Good AM, Go OD, whatever the fuck you want to call it, to swimming.
Yeah.
Pretty impressive music.
Yeah, it's wild.
His evolution's pretty crazy, yeah, too, but it's cool because, like, I never really listened to much of him until, like, after he passed.
Yeah.
But when I went back into his discography and listening to, like, what was on, like, Kool-Aid and Frozen Pizza,
yeah,
and hearing that, it's like, because the first thing I really dove deep into was Swimming,
mm-hmm,
which is, yeah, that's the be-all, end-all. Yeah. And then listening to something like Kool-Aid and Frozen Pizza was, like, I can hear all the potential, and it's
so cool to hear
all the potential come out of that, because it's like, you know what
I'm,
he was trying to
I'm
get at, but
I'm envious of you being able to like take it in the way you did, because like for I guess PK and I, well, I don't know if you listened to him like back in the day like I did when his kids mixtape came out, and Best Day, but I went like, I kind of figured he would just stay as like this recluse, like, I'm going to smoke weed, and that's all I'm going to rap about all the time.
Yeah.
And then it just, like, every record that came out, it, like, grew up with me. So it just, like, took on this weird life of its own, where when Swimming came out, like, I was like, holy shit, like, this is one of the best records yeah. I've ever heard in my life.
Wow.
And then Dumbass goes and dies.
Yeah, well.
And I'm just like, I was so gripped by that record that I was already, like, anticipating what he was going to put out next. Because I was like,
wow.
Is he just going to keep getting better and better and better? Like, where, like, yeah. most artists will have a plateau.
Yeah.
And it comes a lot sooner than what Mac Miller did. Like,
he has a lot of stuff. Yeah. He has a lot of content released.
A lot of content.
There's similarities between, like, Good AM and Swimming. Mm-hmm. They both kind of start off the same way. They both kind of progress in the same style.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty interesting. I was just listening to those two records the other day, and, like, the intro songs are both the same. They start off with, like, a piano, just him kind of rapping and talking, and then it just, like, keeps developing into this crazy song. I think was Dang on. Dang was on Feminine to Divine.
Yes.
Yeah.
With Anderson.
Yeah. I didn't like that fucking album.
It was just really different. It's not that I don't like it. It's just it's not like a replayer for me. Like, I appreciate it for what it is, but it's not one of those records that I'm going to go back and, like, put on all the time.
Interesting.
We're, like, Swimming. Oh, yeah, I do.
Interesting. I just skip over that shit all the time.
That's fair. It was definitely, like, a step out of, like, the trajectory that he was kind of taking, but I feel like it was a necessary step to kind of go, like, oh, this isn't being so well received.
Maybe I'm not.
Yeah, maybe I'll go back onto this path, which is totally fine. And I appreciate artists that do that as opposed to releasing same old, one after another, you know?
I'd rather have them do that and just...
Hell yeah.
Yeah. Otherwise, you're not really progressing as an artist.
Like, I think, like, Kid Cudi might be a good example of this. Like, Man on the Moon 1, Man on the Moon 2 are fucking great records. And then a whole lot of hot garbage, but very different hot garbage from one another. And then... finally, he gets together with Kanye and Kid See Ghosts comes out, and that shit is just, like, wildly amazing to me.
I never think to put that shit on.
Ooh, it's so fresh.
Kid See Ghosts?
Yeah.
See, I never really listened to much Kid Cudi either until Kid See Ghosts.
Oh, okay.
And I kind of, like, tapped into, like, you know, some stuff on Spotify just from previously just to kind of, like... hear where things kind of.
And did you just listen to all his bad music?
No, I didn't listen to all of it, but I just kind of heard it and I was like, it, yeah, like you said, there's a lot of drastic movement, but yeah. I think it's probably he was getting the, because you know how, like, you ever seen the Genius video? I think it's Genius about, like, Day and Night, like the, how the whole beat was made, and you know, like, that beat really. Something? No, it's like some, I forget what the relationship is with the beat producer, but that song really, like, kickstarted his career.
Yeah.
And I think when you're an artist who doesn't really know what they're doing, mm-hmm. and your work gets bigger than you,
just gets skyrocketed.
Yeah, and mm-hmm. it's almost like the entity of, like, what the how far the music is propelling you. You're not really ready for it, so that when you're, like, an artist and you're, you know, your ego's kind of fed with all these people, like, watching you and listening to you and admiring you, you're thinking, like, well, it's my creativity mm-hmm. that is worshipped, mm-hmm. so I'm gonna try whatever I want. And then you go down that route, and sometimes, you know, you're not as experienced in those specific routes, like traversing through those routes, that you take, you know, weird turns on these paths and you kind of go on dead ends, and people are like, people get that, though. People that like too. As much as, like, some people are listeners and they don't really know music well, as long as people are listeners and they might not know music well, but, like, I feel like a lot of those people still can smell, like, bullshit.
Definitely.
Like, out of music. Definitely. And that's kind of a cool thing about, you know, music, is, like, you don't have to be this aficionado of it to be with the collective and, you know, sure. if it's good or not.
Yeah.
Stay yeah. out.
So I think we might have a special guest here.
All right. I think we have an esteemed guest taking a step in, so we're just going to take a quick little break and then we'll be back.
Yeah.
Hey What's up, y'all? We're back, and we're joined by our esteemed and special guest, the Bing-Bong-Bowl.
The Bing-Bonger. Tell us about your Bing-Bong.
Oh, I don't know what it's actually called, but the Bing-Bong is based on this.
Just fucking head explodes.
That's quite the fascinating bowl you've got.
Now why do they call it that?
Do you think the sound would be the same if you're eating ramen out of it at the same time?
It would probably sound more like
that sound. Yeah.
With a subharmonic pitch.
Hey, ASMR's hot now.
Yeah. Yeah, what's up with that weird rise of ASMR like audio?
When I was just getting into Twitch streaming, I was playing some video games and shit, ASMR seemed to have started to like I know it's been around for a while, like
yeah,
6 or 7 years. Yeah. But it started to like really have a huge rise, and like basically as soon as one white woman with blonde hair and a fat ass and big tits does something on the internet,
yep,
a million others do the same thing. And that's kind of exactly what happened.
Really?
Yeah. Just like some fitness model started doing ASMR, and like, I don't know, 100,000 people dogpiled into her stream, and that was all she wrote.
Wow.
It's funny how like ASMR even relates to like porn and stuff like that, you know?
Yeah, well, it's funny to watch people defend it and go, no, it's not a sexual thing. Because to me, somebody who's... I feel uncomfortable listening to ASMR.
Yeah.
It's like not pleasant.
Yeah, it's not pleasant for me. It's not relaxing.
Yeah.
I don't like listening to all that noise.
It's disturbing.
Yeah.
I'd rather just listen to some cannibal corpse. Yeah, but to me, like, as an onlooker, it totally seems like a sexual thing to me.
Yeah.
I think it could easily relate to it because it's supposed to relate to or be like kind of like that tingle you get in like your neck and your shoulders and stuff like that.
Yeah.
It's easily like someone whispering in your ear or something like that.
Yeah. And for the most part, like, I don't think.
I don't think either.
Yeah, I don't think. Yeah. Not at all.
I don't think.
I'm actually dead right now.
Hey.
All right. So, to pick up kind of where we left off, we were going through our musical journeys from smoking trash piles to having some sort of cohesive and succinct musical taste. Each of us have a song loaded up here, and it's kind of like supposed to be a pinnacle or turning point for our musical tastes. And it's maybe not the exact song, but it might encapsulate a period of time.
Maybe.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Where things like really change for us musically. So
is this actually like a turning point
for me? This specific song was a turning point. So I'll give a little bit of backstory to it. So I had always listened to things that were kind of like hip hop adjacent. I listened to like a lot of gorillas who would feature hip hop artists and stuff like that. No, never.
So good.
I would love to though.
Hell
but
yeah.
Those tickets, man.
Yeah.
A little pricey.
That's steep.
So They would always have this artist on, Dell, who would perform as like Russell's ghost, and I was like fascinated with this guy's lyricism and just like the way his voice sounded. It was like super nice. So I started looking into him as an artist, and I came across his original group Souls of Mischief, which
so good.
I know to like.
I know he's from that.
Yeah, a lot of people would be like, oh, Souls of Mischief, like quintessential hip-hop group, but I'm a white boy from suburban Canada. I'm not surrounded by anybody who's exposing me to, like, old-school hip-hop like this. It's not on the radio. None of my friends are listening to it. I just kind of, like, stumbled across it, and through this music, like, it gave me a huge appreciation for, like, old-school boom-bap style, lots of samples being used, lots of really, like, nice percussive drums, really slappy drums going on.
Slaps.
And yeah, it really changed how I looked at hip hop, because all I ever heard was just shit that was playing on the radio, and
right.
I didn't vibe to the sound. I didn't relate to the lyrics at all. Like Souls of Mischief, the way they do their lyrics, it's kind of like funny. It's just like a bunch of guys, they just play off one another. It's no different than if like the four of us decided to start writing, but we didn't take ourselves too seriously or anything. So it's like, it was a really easy and like low entry point for me to get into and expand from there. So okay. Like for if me, you want to pop it on, I think it's skipped a little bit into the song, so you might just have to rewind it a bit.
Was that Cab Fare?
Yeah, dude.
All the way?
Yeah.
So where did you hear this first?
So I...
Church?
Like, where was the place, like, when it came on and you're like, oh,
oh my God, I was, so my parents had this desktop computer,
yeah,
and it was the only computer we had in the house at the time, and it was in their bedroom, and I was only allowed to use it for like an hour a day.
It's a strange place.
It was a weird place for a computer.
Very strange.
But,
blazed fat.
Was your dad up late?
No. So here's the thing.
It wasn't like that, man.
We didn't, it was so old, it didn't have an open PCI lane to have a wireless card in it, so we had to have it hardwired. That was the only way. Like, this is a, we're talking like a Dell XPS from like 1994.
Getting and really defensive here, buddy.
No. I think it's important for the backstory. It's about okay. It was the same color as this table. Nice. Nasty gray.
What?
It's beautiful gray.
Yeah, come on, man.
And yeah, it had to be hardwired, and the only place we had a Cat 5 hardwire was in the upstairs, and they weren't going to put it in my room, and they weren't going to put it in my brother's room, so it went their room. So I heard it, and I rocked out, and I thought it was super dope, and then my computer time was over, so I couldn't investigate Christian anymore. But yeah, you want to let this one play?
Yeah. Put her on.
Yeah, hit it.
I'd love to.
Thanks.
Thank you, man.
Yeah.
And it's super simple. Yeah, it's not on any of their, I think it's from a mixtape that never has been on like streaming platforms and stuff, so you can only find it on like SoundCloud and YouTube. And the samples and beat is like super simple, but I'd never really heard anything like this before. I didn't know you could just snatch melodies and stuff from other music and just put it in your own, and like then it becomes a thing. Hey, in case you guys were wondering, that's Souls of Mischief.
A couple of handsome fellas right here.
Do you know if they're still together? Is that what they
Yeah, they still perform together. Now, I haven't listened to much of like their new stuff, just because...
When was this released?
Fuck. It's got to be like 93, 94. It's a long time ago. So now that I've said it, it's going to be horribly
a true classic. Thanks, man.
It was released in the year of a true classic.
Yeah.
Now, as you guys can imagine, for somebody who never really listened to a lot of hip-hop when I was younger, this is something that was like super chill.
Yeah.
And easily digestible for me.
But were you like, yo, this sounds super chill when you were a kid, or were you like, this is hard as fuck?
I heard that keyboard roll, and I was just like, something about it really grabbed me. Just the way it was like riding over the drums, and like the lyricism just came as an afterthought, you know? Like, I was going, wow, this beat's really cool. And I listened to it probably like 10 or 15 times in a row, and then I started listening to the lyrics. I'm like, oh, these guys are just like kind of chilling and just having fun, and like, whatever,
awesome.
Like, it's not too serious or anything like that. I'm not saying like this is the one song where I was just like, okay, my life is different. No.
But never going to be the same again.
This encapsulates a time where I was exploring a very different kind of music than what I would normally listen to. And this was just one of the first songs, I think, that caught my attention to lead me down that path where you take like a wild turn.
Okay.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because then it went from this to me listening to like Nas's Illmatic, which is another like super quintessential record that like obviously everybody in the world knows about. But for me, suburban white boy coming across that for the first time, I'm like, whoa,
yeah,
this is fucking wild and different. Like,
that was like Immortal Technique. Remember that?
Yes.
Yeah, hearing like his lyricism, and you're like, because the devil. Oh, what is it? Because I was with Billy Jacobs and I raped his mom too. And you're like, oh,
yeah, man.
God.
That shit was crushing.
Yeah.
So dark.
I think that was really cool about getting into hip hop and stuff, because it's like they usually provide a lot of relatable content.
Yeah.
And even like the fact that they don't just sample like old hooks and stuff. They sample actual real world sounds.
Pause the
tune
before it plays to the next random thing.
Yeah, true. Fuck. That's
take it from the top.
One more
from the top.
That was part of why I really got into hip hop as well, just because it was like
super
relatable. It sounded like it was almost like I say this because like I've been looking into soundscapes and stuff. It was almost like the soundscape of my brain, like the vibe of it and everything.
Yeah,
because it was like it was hype, but it was also mundane. And it was like, you know what I mean?
Yeah, for sure. Yeah. I totally get that.
Yeah,
definitely.
For me, too, it's a sound that is totally, at least to me, attainable. Like, when I listen to some of my favorite bands, I'm like, I'm never going to be a god like that. Like, that's on some whole next level. But then I listen to hip-hop, and I'm like, well, I could find a keyboard that sounds like that, and I could make a drum sample that sounds like that, and I can find a friend to write lyrics that sound like that, you know? Like, it's there, it's tangible, it's real. Where I listen to Rush, and I'm like, yeah, fucking right, I could ever touch something like that.
Yeah.
Like, not even close.
There's a finesse certain. It's because it's like, it's those members, and they're all being portrayed as themselves, representing their music.
Yeah.
Whereas, like, one artist is like, you know, there's so much behind it.
Yeah, for sure.
Whereas
for sure.
They kind of personify it. Mm-hmm. And it's more attainable to you, whereas there's this complexity of like a bunch of people.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I think part of that is because it's attainable/accessible in the way like it could be simplified, like to just beatboxing and rapping on the street. Someone tries to tell you like what Rush sounds like. They're just going to be doing a bunch of like air drums and whatever else, which is fine. But
what
I mean,
song is that?
I don't know.
Like it takes.
I was
off
getting
from
excited.
That, like,
he was getting me in the zone.
Takes a lot from that like poetic aspect of like music,
for sure,
kind of
for
like
sure.
Like we were talking in music history class the other day about Gil Scott-Heron, like a lot of because we were talking about hip hop because he was one of like the advocates for that around that time. They were doing a lot of like. Kind of black movement, spoken word kind of stuff,
right,
you know?
Right.
Even like not too long before people like Afrika Bambaataa and stuff like that.
Yeah.
You know? So I'm just saying it's attainable, accessible. You know?
Sure. Cool.
Yeah.
All right. Whose tune is up next?
Yo, is this Poppy's?
Me?
You want to defend it?
Sure. I guess it was kind of just, I'll just preface it with the story that I was telling before a little bit when I was. It was kind of the pivotal moment of when I started getting into more like edgier, heavy music. Cause you know, I think for me, like what defines heavy is just like high energy, and it can kind of be subjective. Like pop punk is heavy, but it's heavy for pop music. It's pop punk. You
know?
Yeah.
Yeah. And then anyway, so what I'm trying to say is just like, this was more for like rock and that kind of whole thing. And I was on my way where I listened to it was on my way to my aunt's house on Christmas. Stop the presses. Special guest Jordan here.
Save some space.
Hey, man.
How are you doing?
Hey, happy late birthday to you.
Thank you.
Sir.
Thank you. Thank you.
Oh, we're all friends.
What's going on? Okay.
Hey.
Oh, hey, Evan.
Nice hairdo. Nice hairdo.
What? Oh, are we live?
Oh, yeah, we are.
Hell yeah,
we're live, man. What's going on?
Perra.
Sorry, I stepped on a bunch of stuff.
Okay, so we have a special guest.
Number two.
Second special guest after the Bing-Bong-Bowl. This is Jordan. This is the Bing-Bong-Bowl.
Oh, cool. Oh, jeez, is it a ghost?
This is Jordan, the world's greatest Bill Burr impersonator.
Yeah, what's going on, dude?
And Tom DeLonge.
Oh, Jesus. Don't waste your time. We're playing a Blink song, right, this next show.
Are you actually?
We're practicing at his... Yeah,
that aliens exist on. We were playing at his fucking place, and there's no mic.
At Bill Burr's place?
At Bill Burr's place, at Fatty's place, and my fucking... Dude, my fucking I'm gonna blow my voice out, man. Holy shit. It's
Take
fucking
it easy,
high,
Kai.
Man.
All right. So this is Jordan from the band Illicit.
Yep.
Yeah, give it up. Yeah. Whoa.
Okay, so to drop you into where we're at right now, basically we've covered our whole musical history, each of us as an individual.
Oh.
Going from for me, I went from Aaron Carter up to like the hip hop that I listen to now.
Who's Aaron Carter?
Oh yeah, he might be before your time.
That's not a bad thing.
Nick Carter from the Backstreet Boys.
Oh yeah,
his younger brother.
Was he in the Backstreet Boys?
No, he was not. But he always won.
He's like the Ashley Simpson.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, we kind of went from like, okay, I'm 6 and I listen to shit, and up until okay, I'm 25 and I think
I still listen to shit.
I listen to shit, but yeah. Other people are on board with that same shit.
Cool.
So we're just playing like a couple songs that were like a turning point for us, where you went like, oh, hot damn,
yeah,
this music thing is real.
Yeah, it's like hitting puberty with music, you know.
Shit,
so, or even further.
If you want to play Ian's song while we kind of talk about it a little bit more?
Sure.
This is a long one.
So I'll kind of say that the story was when I started listening to this, or where it happened was on my way to Christmas. To my aunt's house. On Christmas, on the way to my aunt's house in Toronto, and I was listening to Blink-182 on a Walkman. My cousin just pops this on his car stereo in a CD. I kind of like take off my earphones and I say like something like, "Oh, what is this?" Or he kind of mentions, he's like, "Hey, Ian, listen to this," or something like that. And then he's like, "This is good music." And then I remember I just sat there and it was,
"Don't waste your time on this."
This is just like, I miss you. And I'm like looking at the wall, it's like snowing, like, you know, on the highway, just looking at like the old farms and stuff. Anyways, so this is pretty much what hit it for me, and I had those small little MP3 players, so I started nudging out, you know, like other bands, like, because I was really into like even like Jimmy Eat World for like a little time, and then I started like inching out certain artists, and then I kind of inched this song in, and then a few more, and then that's how it all happened. Yeah.
So is this the song playing now?
Yeah, it is. It's by Tool. The band is called Tool.
Oh, okay.
It's a Eulogy. It kind of has a slow build-up, I know, but it's just like, this is the song that reminds you of like the pivotal moment.
Yeah, oh,
you know?
for sure. Oh, yeah. Tool was definitely like a big changing point for me, too. Like, I never knew that music could sound like somebody was making a big ol' stew.
Yeah,
big ol' stew.
Like, it's just, as it simmers, it gets better and better and better and better, and then it hits like this crescendo, and you just... Then you're eating the stew and it's fucking delicious.
Eating the stew, man.
Maybe you got a stew going.
This is good meat on that.
Yeah, some carrots melting the pot right now.
I think I'd like my money back.
What about you, Jordan? Is there any, like, what's like the worst shit you were listening to when you were younger?
The first thing I ever like listened to that I liked on my own in first grade was the first Evanescence album.
Damn, that's a bold statement. I hope you know that's out on the internet forever.
That's right, man. The first Evanescence album heard it through fucking Daredevil.
Okay.
Daredevil.
On the music video, on the bonus fucking feature.
That's wild. Crazy. That's wild.
Fucking Daredevil.
I really like this band.
I like this band. I don't know, man.
So you're the type of guy who's going into the bonus features, too. You're hitting this with a double whammy here.
Dude, when I was, like, in third grade, I'd watch all, like, the Star Wars, like, bonus feed. I'd watch, like, How They Were Made and shit. Yeah. And fucking the green screen, man. The guns and the rubber guns and stuff. And then George was
so
big jowls. The whole movie, man, when you watch it, they have like one guy in a suit and it's all green.
Yeah, they only hired one actor.
They didn't even need a budget for that movie. Yeah. They need like $20.
So from Evanescence, like, where did you go from there?
Okay, so it's kind of weird. So that was my grade one, right? Evanescence. And then I didn't listen to anything really long time. My parents, they always have like Ja Rule.
Ja Rule, your parents?
Ja Rule, yeah, like whatever, hip hop was like popular like 2003, 2004.
Shaggy.
Evanescence to Ja Rule?
It gets worse. Evanescence, I swear to God, Kiss.
To Kiss,
that was my first
one.
I got Guitar Hero 3, and I'd never heard that kind of music before.
It fit right in here.
Yeah, and then fucking, Kiss, and then Aerosmith. I had both their greatest hits records.
Nice.
And then from that, I went to Oh, no. The bigger one than that, though, that stood out, I still like to say, is the first Killers record.
Yeah.
I still love that album. That one's sick.
Agreed.
And
agreed.
From that, I went into, like, Slipknot. And that was, like, nuts.
It's quite a change.
I know, yeah. Just from that to that. But Slipknot was probably... It's hard, man, because, like, I feel like Slipknot, Nirvana, and Blink were such, like, huge bands for me. And then from there got me into all the punk rock stuff. But, like, you're talking about songs, maybe?
It doesn't have to specifically be a song. Like, we were trying to encapsulate what this is. It might just be, like, a moment in time where, like, a specific album did it for you, or just an artist, like, and you could just pick a song from that.
Music that just, like, shifted your whole interest into being more energetic, more aggressive, more angsty, more whatever. Just kind of that next step in your life.
Yeah, let's talk about the angst. Let's get into the angst a little bit.
Yeah, yeah. I'll go with Nirvana.
Okay.
Yeah, I'll go with Nirvana. So yeah. I'm cool, man. Yeah, so.
Yeah, for me, Nirvana was a weird one, too, because I was like, yo, before I really knew who they were, Kurt Cobain was already dead.
Yeah.
And I'm like, well, his music doesn't sound that sad. Like, what happened?
Dude, yeah. Utero is a fucking phenomenal piece of work.
Yeah, hell yeah.
Yeah, Utero's sick. I love that one.
Yeah, I have it on vinyl.
Oh,
so
nice.
Fucking good, man.
It's awesome.
What was so good about it for you? That seems kind of like it's, you know, kind of
I don't know,
hitting
man,
you in a certain spot
know.
Right now.
Like the creepy tones that you get on, like, Milk It.
Yeah, ding, dong.
Like, he fucking, I don't know what he did on that album, but it's so fucking good. I get, like, goosebumps thinking about it.
That's heroin, dude. Lane Staley and Alice in Chains did the same shit. There's a certain 8-month period where when you first start doing heroin, you're gonna make the best music of your life. Bradley Knowles, Sublime, pull that shit off. Fucking Perry Farrell in Jane's Addiction, pull that shit off.
I don't know.
There's something.
You can't just blame it. You can't just say that it's.
I will.
Of the
I will. It's a common thread.
There's
and
some
I wish there wasn't.
There.
Oh, totally, totally. But I think heroin might be the drug of the most tortured artist, you know?
But it's almost, like, super pure. Like, every time you hear, like, some artists, like, bonked out on heroin, it's like, you always just, like, take a moment with it. You know what I mean? Like, for example, like, John Frusciante.
Yeah,
like,
I was just going to bring him up.
Like, that really, you know, that era where you watch, like, the videos on YouTube where he's all strung out and shit.
Yeah,
and you, like,
it almost, like, it melts their walls, their boundaries, and they're just going to give you... themselves.
It's literally just
separates the boys from the men.
Yeah.
This episode of the Ape Audio Podcast brought to you by heroin.
We'll change your life up.
Head down to the trench coat man on King Street. Present him with the offer code Ape.
Yep.
Coming to
see
it now.
See what happens.
You.
10%
discount.
That's funny, dude.
Cyber okay, so like,
fuck. Here, yeah, fuck. And you're right.
Yeah. Yeah, I'm just like the guitar sounds that he's pulling out on like Radio Friendly Unit Shifter. You're like, what the fuck are you doing?
Yeah,
it's so.
Most of that album was live track too.
Yeah,
like drums, like, guitars, bass.
Albini fucking kills it.
Yeah,
yeah.
Damn.
They just put away those mics in like a museum or whatever. He was doing some video on it.
Yeah,
and
it
was, like,
yeah. Bang
used
that.
And shit.
Really?
And, like, sane into.
Yeah.
Pretty cool.
So yeah. Is that where your taste lies now, or, like, has it branched out more?
It's.
I know you're a little younger than us, so, like...
Well, like, okay, so Nirvana was a big one for me, and that's, I swear that, like, it's pretty much all I listened to for, like, a year straight, feel like.
Yeah.
And then once I got in the Blink, it was kind of that same thing again, but it got me into, like, a bunch of punk rock bands.
Oh, yeah.
So they had that Urethra Chronicles CD, right?
Yeah.
And they go through, like, like, Descendants and Pennywise and That Religion, and I got into all those and just went off into that.
Yeah, it's funny. Like, I actually kind of took a similar path. Like, I was listening to, like, a lot of Sum 41 and Blink 182.
Yeah.
And then I was like, oh, well, maybe I should, like, go pay homage to, like, where punk actually came from. Because all the old heads keep telling me this is a bastardization of what punk was.
Oh, yeah.
So then you got to go back and you listen to, like, The Clash, The Ramones. Like, you get into, like, the third wave punk where you listen to, like, NoFX and, like, Black Flag, shit like that.
Mm.
And, it's, like, a cool little journey to hear all that and, like, how much politics and, like, anger was, like, bottled up into, like, the first and second waves of punk, and then to have, like, Sum 41 and Blink 182 where they're like, we're just trying to have fun.
And that kind of came from the Descendants too, because they had, like, like, just, yeah, they had like joke songs.
Yeah,
and they didn't
sure.
take themselves seriously and yeah. stuff too. And yeah, it's like all like those like Lagwagon and all those fat record bands and yes. stuff like that. They're all from like Descendants. It's pretty crazy.
Cool.
Yeah.
All right. So
TV party
Patrick,
tonight.
You got your all tune right. next.
Yeah. Vocal.
I would walk to band practice from my house currently all the way past St. Dominic's. And I don't know how I stumbled upon this fucking...
Oh, that's so cool.
I don't know how I stumbled upon this song, but it was playing on my way to band practice, and it reminded me a lot of Queens of the Stone Age. It's like, I'm really, really into that band. Have been for a few years. Many years, I guess. And it's like hearing this kind of get like showed me where they got that like fuck you kind of attitude that they have now.
Yeah.
Where they're just like fucking up Jay-Z's parties. I forget what the whole story was, but like I think they showed up to one of his parties and they weren't getting let in and they were just being treated like shit, so they just started knocking shit over, breaking stuff.
They just fucked shit up.
Yeah. And then Jay-Z's like, yo, chill, man.
Did he let him in?
Yeah. Let me sign you.
Yeah. They, so now they're on Jay-Z's label, boy.
I didn't know that.
Really?
That's super interesting.
And yeah, this song.
Oh, yeah.
It's, I forget what year it is.
Gotta be like mid-70s or something.
Yeah.
Did you guys also know that Iggy Pop is like an insanely
alive.
Beast mode drummer? Like he can listen to anything you play.
Up, down.
He'll listen to any song and he'll just be able to like recreate it. Like he would make like a fantastic session drummer.
Really?
Yeah. He'll just hit it like immediately.
And it's pretty crazy because like Queens of the Stone Age and Iggy Pop, I think they got together and made an album just recently.
Yeah.
Oh really?
Yeah.
Holy smokes. That,
yeah,
how did
so,
that fly past me?
So like that, it's pretty interesting that they made that connection. Yeah, I don't know, just like those guitar tones. It's kind of a gave me a new outlook on shit. Face to
face. The quest for tone.
Yeah, kind of.
You hear that tone, bro?
But also
hear
just
that
like,
tone?
But also not really giving too much of a fuck. Before
it's just tight enough
yeah.
to impress you, but just sloppy enough to like.
Cause I don't like. I'm always going back to this new metal stuff. It's like it sounds
like
good.
Like Biscuit.
Not
like,
new metal.
Like,
yeah.
Brand new metal.
Prog
stuff.
Oh, like Prague. Okay,
yeah.
Okay, okay.
Yeah, it's just like it sounds fucking amazing, but it's just like it sounds too good.
Yeah, yeah, some it's of it's like, lifeless.
Yeah,
because you know?
It's like
because like,
when you're saying
it's
like,
perfect. It's perfect. Yeah, it's just like it's perfect. I don't want to listen to perfect.
Yeah,
all
the
time.
Thing is yeah. Sometimes
sure,
you like to you
sure.
like to listen to something a little bit more like like a rustic, artisanal. Kinda, no, there's some,
I want to feel like there's
vibe.
A flair there.
There's
like
a vibe,
I listen
yeah.
to stuff like this, and I can picture the band. I listen to some yeah. newer prog,
and you're like this, is
and
just too calculated.
Yeah, it's
yeah.
like
yeah.
they
yeah.
could swap
I
out.
Totally
it just sounds like
that.
A bunch of session players to me.
Yeah.
Like you could swap out any of the members,
yeah.
and
yeah.
it wouldn't matter to me at all. Like
and
nobody's bringing a succinct vibe. Whereas like let's
yeah.
say let's say Periphery. I know you're not the biggest Periphery fan.
Don't know him.
But they bring this kind of vibe where if any of those players left, the band would not sound the same.
But is that also not what makes a good band? Is like this well-oiled machine of like members that are playing so that are creating so harmoniously well that like they are literally dependent on each other? Because like, what if one of those members left the band? And then you'd be like, and if they sounded the same, you'd be like, well, I guess they like. And what if it just kept happening where it just kept like these members kept shifting?
Yeah, but how many times have you seen that happen? It happens in the metal scene all the time.
Think,
where
yeah,
people
because,
are dropping members and picking other people
I actually read this
up.
In Zen and the Art of Producing by Mixer Man that they're like two kinds of bands, and one is like what I just described, like the perfectly harmonious, like all members like contribute equally,
like
or there's the brainchild.
Okay.
Basically.
Okay, sure,
yeah.
sure. You think
and
there's like a conductor, like somebody...
Like someone who's like... Yeah, just kind of like directs everything. There's pretty much two.
Yeah, that's fair.
Yeah.
I was going to say like...
Like Tool is an example compared to, well, Iggy Pop.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, yeah.
I think it's just like what you want to get out of the music. Because with this, it's kind
oh,
of more
true.
Like energy
sure.
based. And
yeah.
The metal is more kind of like
mm-hmm.
technical. You're listening to...
The detail.
It's tapping
yeah.
into your chakras, man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you want to get out of yodeling?
I want to expand my consciousness. I want to rip that third eye open.
My third eye.
Jordan, do you want to play a tune? Did you think anything
something
up?
That was more pivotal in your
musical
upbringing. Like, what was a song that you can remember from a specific moment in your life? You know,
oops, I did it again.
Oops, I did it again.
I'm a slave for you.
Man, that's hard to think. Let's see. Come on. What's one? You know what? Like.
He actually doesn't like music.
I don't listen to music.
I'm actually deaf.
I never cared for it whatsoever. Man, that's like it's hard to think because there's like a.
It's fucking tough.
A few of those.
It's a little thought experiment.
You know
it,
what?
It doesn't have to be like
my brain don't work.
Like, it doesn't have to be the most important. It just has to be something that you remember from a very specific point in your life.
But it also has to be the most important.
Yeah.
If it's not, we're kicking you.
Yeah.
I'm gonna go with fucking. See if I can spell this right. Okay, there it is.
Spell it out.
I'll go with this one because this was such like. This is. Actually, you know what? I'm gonna go a different one because I. Hold on. I'm gonna go this.
What does it say, PK?
Should I say? Patrick.
Mm-hmm. Okay, Left Behind by Slipknot. Cause I remember. Slipknot, like I said before, they're like one of those big bands for me. But I remember one time, my parents, they had like that Sirius radio in the car.
Yeah.
And so I was like, can I put on like Octane, whatever?
Like Alice Cooper station?
Yeah. So it was like the rock station or whatever. And this song came on, and this is like the first time ever I heard that song. It's like, you know, like that's Iowa by Slipknot. That album's like I think it's voted like the fourth heaviest like album of all time. Mm-hmm. Something like that. It's fucking like so heavy.
How do you rate heaviness?
I don't know.
I don't know.
The
scale?
At the same time, on the number one, they had like fucking Black Sabbath, and that's like compared to that, it's like no.
This album weighs a lot.
But anyways, I remember just my mom saying, "Wow, that sounds really heavy," something like that. I don't know. It's like I don't know.
Goddamn
it's cool.
Right, it does.
It just fucking like.
Oh.
It's just so fucking sick. It's like the first time I ever heard anything like that heavy before. And
it's crazy because like one of the main sources of like getting music back then, it was a little bit harder, was like music videos, was like having them appear on TV. It's just like, oh!
Much loud before school every morning.
Yeah.
That's where I learned that Alexis on Fire, Lamb of God.
Oh, cool. It's on the back. That's so good.
Oh, you didn't notice it on the back there?
Yeah, I saw it before with the projection stuff, but I didn't think to look.
This camera setting is really good, man.
Yeah.
God damn.
Shout out to Logitech and the drivers.
Yeah, it's cool.
Shout out to Ian for showing out.
Shout out to Mother Earth. Looking like a piece of toast to
reference previous video.
This was one of the struggles that we had to endure for the 2 months that we were here with this lighting,
bad
a bunch of different stuff,
bad video quality,
tripping on. So when you first saw like the mask, you know the
smoking cords,
the same
smoking
cords,
man.
No, I'm not.
I don't do the drugs, man.
You're gonna burn your finger, man. Look, your finger looks like fucking ground zero.
This man's living reckless. So I saw, or I heard that you and Foddy were on another podcast. How'd that go? It sounded. I listened to it.
It
was pretty dope.
It was cool being on.
Where was it?
The Walk Show. Yeah.
Play like bands. We did like a couple. And so he just gave us, you know, his contact information to stay in touch with us. And then he said, I'll bring you on the show eventually. And so, yeah, it was cool. So we just stayed in touch with him and did that. And it was fun, man. I don't know, dude. It was cool. I've never done that before. He's got a cutesy pie little studio. Cute mic, the cute part.
Cute mic.
I rolled back and listened to his first episode as a way to guide this first episode. So if you talk to him, give him a shout out.
Okay, cool.
Give him a shout out right now.
What's his name?
It's called The Walk Show Podcast.
A shout out to The Walk Show.
Yeah. It was fun though, man. It was cool. I think we did like over an hour or something.
Cool.
Around there. It was cool. It was a good time. I drank some tea and stuff, man.
Nice. What kind
fucking
of tea
nuts.
You
fucking
the
lit
show?
It up.
Yo,
yeah.
I get pretty lit on tea. What kind of tea you drink?
But I don't know, man. I give it to me at Tim Hortons.
I just dip a bag in.
I spray out when I drink tea, man. It's like crazy.
Yeah.
I'm okay.
I can't
drink coffee. I can't drink energy drinks.
I sure can
sip on a tea.
Sip on a tea, man. Time I go to drink a tea, though, it's cold. I'll make it hot, and I'll take two sips, and then I had to do something, and then it's cold, and then I'll make it again, and it's cold.
I always take one sip, and it's too hot, so then I leave it for like 15 minutes, then it's cold.
Do you ever do the ice cube?
Oh, I've been doing the ice cube a lot lately.
No.
It helps, believe it or not.
Lauren always tells me to, but I feel like it's a bastardization. I don't want iced tea.
It's not iced tea.
I don't want medium
tea. It's just
medium
tea? With an ice cube tea in it.
Yeah, it kind of... Why are you... Yo, man.
I put ice cubes down my pants once when I was 14 at home. It's for fun.
Was it fun?
It was fun the first. Like, I got some laughs.
How many people are around?
How many pets?
Three.
But
I'm like,
hey,
I'll make you laugh here.
Hey, guys, you
want to
see something weird?
Check this shit out.
And then what did you do after? You just walked around?
It just melted
pants.
Around. I was like 14, so I was probably wearing like black jean shorts from fucking the bargain shop or whatever.
What's your favorite bargain shop?
I'm going to go. This one's not around anymore, but it was called the bargain shop.
Hey,
it was just called that. I liked that one.
And then all they sold was black jeans.
Black jeans and Guy Fieri sauce. That's what they sold. Guy Fieri sauce and black jeans. And one time I got some headphones in there.
Did you get the sauce?
I didn't get the sauce. I left the sauce. You know Dexter Holland from The Offspring?
Yes.
He's got sauce, hot sauce. I got some at fucking like Winners or something.
Tie-in.
He's got to fucking pay off those planes. He's got, nine fucking jetliners.
What?
You know?
Yeah, he's a pilot, isn't
he?
Yeah,
he's worth like $80 million or something like that. Hey, something about his mixing. He always sounds far away when he's in every Offspring song.
Really?
Yeah.
I wonder if it's the SM58. You can be like, as an educator once taught us, you can be 3 feet away from the SM58.
What a great educator.
Well, he's fucking 20, man, because he's fucking sounds so far away.
Yeah.
I sound like in a cave every time I fucking hear Knott's fringe on.
Probably just drowns it in reverb.
Maybe.
Yeah.
Sounds the exact same, though.
Maybe he is in a cave.
From like 20 years ago.
He just lives in a cave and he's just like sending his tracks from the cave.
That's pretty excellent, man. Trying to pay off those
points.
He
like
comes
in,
down.
Okay,
he like
puts
ready his thing and just sends it up on a rope.
Yeah, at the top. Wants a rope.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Whoa.
A good,
are they still dropping
me?
Music?
Yeah.
Oh, they've been fucking saying every time I go on dyingscene.com the last 7 years, Offspring might have a new album.
They have.
Okay, and they put out a song for Sharknado and it sucked.
Oh damn!
Like it's coming out. And that was like 2 years ago. They said the album was coming out.
Put back down so quickly.
Dang.
It was literally like this. I swear to God, Sharknado.
Was he in a cave?
Sharknado.
Let's fucking put it on, man.
Look for Sharknado, man. I swear, Sharknado. Fucking sucks, man.
Give it to me, baby.
The fucking song. That's like one of their better ones. Oh yeah.
The future is now.
The fucking the background saying the Billy Talent's the best. But it proves your limousine. Boys will come back to haunt you. Right. I'm out of strength.
Maybe I'll just search.
Or whatever. I don't know how that guy gets his fucking hair up, man.
Gel.
His fucking hair. Gel and
believe it or not.
Wood. You fucking.
Yes. Gel and
wood.
Wood
fibers.
Yeah, you need something to keep the base up, man. You seen his fucking
your
hair.
Base
my hair.
Weak,
man.
My comb is just a broken off branch.
Yeah, that's what he uses to brush it up.
Yeah.
His maple leaf guitar.
This what?
You ever seen that? When I saw him playing, he had half a maple leaf on his Stratocaster.
Oh. The process of finding this song was so long that
hey man,
I'm this is it.
What year is this from?
72.
2016. 72.
Okay.
I swear
it's wrong.
Great, 72. Great year.
Let's
great
play
year.
It. I swear it goes
great year. Greater cars.
Papa John's.
Papa John's.
Oh, sorry. Draw it out more.
What?
Get out of here.
This is why I was embarrassed.
Get out of here.
Having the Oscars?
This is happening. Oh, yeah. Yes. I did see that, actually. When they traded, the Offspring did a 311 cover. And 311 did an Offspring cover. Oh. I didn't know that.
Oh, Noodles does a guitar slide.
Granted, I never listened to 311. So. I actually unironically listened to a bunch of 311.
Really?
Younger, yeah.
What is it about them? Sell them to me.
Oh, what is it, sir?
Oh, so it was just
I was just like really baked, and I'm like, yeah, this is pretty chill. God. And then you would get a little less baked. You'd be like, oh, God. Why have I been listening to this?
You get baked again.
And then you just switch to like regular reggae.
Yeah.
Regular reggae. Chop, 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 chop.
Some Bob Marley, something like that.
I want Ratchet albums all like reggae.
Queens of Stone Age singer fucking stole that dude's girlfriend.
Hell yeah.
Yeah, man, stole her.
Josh Holm.
Josh yeah. Holm. Hey, you fucking prick. Every time I see him, he's calling someone prick.
You fucking prick. I'm not even fucking that up. You fucking
a mile. Fucking bitch. Why you come up here and fight? That's dude. Right. You kicked out, you fucking bitch.
I fucking lost so much respect for him when he kicked a chick in the face.
Oh, did he?
Oh, yeah. He apologized.
I
don't give a fuck. Do that shit? What are you? What are you?
What are you? Some.
Get your stinking foot off me!
Yeah.
Ah, God! Fucking sitting so high up, and fucking just kicked it right off the stage. Yeah. That was in Toronto, the Virgin Mobile Club. They're banned from playing there.
Who?
The.
Hey, dude.
I'll be back.
Some people just deserve it.
Oh, yeah. It's like weird to do that anyway. It's dumb.
Yeah.
Like, you don't go up and.
Kind of like that song.
Sharknado.
Sharknado. What the hell was that?
But it's stuck in your fucking head.
That guy owns planes.
I guess that's what planes will get
you. He owns planes, man. What fucking horse shit is that?
Sharknado.
What?
Nice what? Thanks, man. What are you ever written?
That's the best when you're gonna make a reference and you can't think of the fucking name.
But
I do that all the time.
I hate that. Sharknado.
Fuck you, man.
Listen,
that song
I saw
is
Sharknado.
Stuck in my head like crazy right now.
It's stuck in your head,
now,
man.
Can we just put that on one more time?
Yeah, sure, no problem.
Put it on one more time.
Keep it on just Sharknado one more time.
How about a Boxcar Racer?
Oh, yeah, I love Boxcar Racer.
I love that record.
Do you?
Yes.
Did you like plus 40? Yeah, did you like plus 44?
I'll be there when your
heart stops beating. Be there when your fucking soul's taken away, wherever it goes. I love plus 44.
Yeah.
Wee, man.
Did you like plus 44?
Oh, I loved plus 44.
Yeah. Travis Barker had those clear drums.
I went to go see
him
live when he hit Travis Barker's
arm.
You
saw him
broken.
Live with that?
Oh, yeah. At the Phoenix.
With
yeah.
plus 44?
Yeah.
Fuck,
Ian
man.
Actually went on stage and played guitar.
Oh,
God.
Geez.
Damn it.
Yeah, but Travis Barker had his arm broken.
Yeah.
He was playing with like a trigger that would trigger the snare.
Yeah.
So he was like, yeah.
And he's all the cymbal shit.
Yeah, some crazy shit like that.
And then Mark had his fucking bass. It's cool. Yeah, plus 44 is sick.
How about Angels and Airwaves?
Yeah.
Oh, I was super into fucking the first
four or five
records. Actually, you know what?
Four or five, Jesus Christ.
Actually, I like them all, actually. I like the newest one they did when he just did it with the guy who used to play in, like, Lost Prophets and stuff like that.
Oh, the rapist guy?
Yeah, not the rapist, but the drummer of the rapist.
Oh, great.
The drummer of the rapist.
He didn't know it was
right
by the time.
That's fucked up stuff.
Really cool. They had this really spooky song on there. What's it called?
We know a rapist.
Just with a spell or something like that. It's fucking cool.
I like Angel Eric a lot. They're sick.
Okay. Yeah. How about, I lost it.
Ah, shit.
What? I lost
There's
it.
No other Blink-182 offshoots.
30 Seconds to Mars?
30 Seconds to Mars?
I saw them. Fuck me.
Was there anybody else like that, like in that Jared Leto sense that had a
dude,
band
it's
that
so, like,
is
theatrical.
Successful as well as someone as an actor that's like also as successful?
Ah, man.
Fucking thumbnails for those videos, man. They look like fucking movies.
I know.
Helmet on.
It's ridiculous. Their music was fucking shite.
Matt Watcher, their bass player, who
played in Angels and Airwaves used to play in 30 Seconds on Mars and then swapped over to that.
I feel like there isn't much of a difference
really?
Between the bands.
Never, I heard
but
that
I've,
one
I
song.
Actually never really listened to Angels and Airwaves. I don't know why I'm saying that.
What's an Angels and Airwaves song? Put one on.
Oh, what's it? One of my favorite? Okay. Oh, hold on.
Uh-oh.
Fuck.
He's slipping.
Which one should I do?
I don't know.
Oh, The Adventure was the first one I heard.
Yeah, The Adventure.
That one's sick. His vocals, I love what
we all know. The Adventure.
The Adventure, yeah. I love what they did with his vocals, man, on those first two records.
This was actually a...
they sound so good.
Because when Plus 44 came out and The Adventure came out, like when Your Heart Stops Beating and this was like the first two songs, the first two like breakthrough songs of their own like accord that they came out with.
Yeah.
And it's interesting to see how this branched off from the self-titled Blink album.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like this vibe came off because you can notice it is similar. It has similar elements to the self-titled vibe.
Uh-huh.
And Plus 44's album also has that.
Yes.
But they, to hear the independence is really cool.
I think so. You know what the interlude on that Plus 44 record remind me of? Remind me a lot of like The Cure or something like that. Like Mark's bass line. And more like, it had like this weird like, I don't know, there's just a lot of cool like different like modern kind of poppy sounds to it as far as the instruments went. Plus 44. But.
Is this like one of their first songs that came out?
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Look at him looking so off into space. He's like.
Was this like off their first record?
Scream again! What a wake up! For a live!
I love this one.
My dearest friend.
I believe in UFOs.
Yeah, when he got abducted by aliens and they just brought him back down to Earth and they're like, spread the message.
Look at this Jupiter in the back and the planets keep changing.
That's Adam World.
Look, now there's Earth. They're just.
These guys travel.
The planets just keep changing.
That drummer.
Look, now there's Jupiter, and you'll just see Earth just randomly.
Oh, is this Angels
appear.
And Airwaves?
Yeah.
Has he discovered a UFO yet?
He just said something about that. Yeah.
Now they're going through a.
Oh my God! Is
time
actually,
warp.
Is he actually in a UFO? In this
thing?
Yeah. It's like a spaceship.
Dude, he just keeps cycling.
Has he read his own book yet?
To the stars.
Yep. Got it.
I'd like to spend $200 on
this Cialis commercial scene. It's like that in the field.
Fuck! Yeah. Where's Tom Boner, man?
Yeah, right that, those scenes.
My day, good place! Fuck, man. I love this record, though, man. It's so good. Really, dude. Fuck.
It's really good, man. And I was we were just talking about this while you were gone. It was, Plus 44's album and this album was like the first releases they made independently.
Yeah, I was just going to ask Jordan if he, when they all went to do like their own projects, did you follow all?
I didn't become a fan until 2011.
Interesting.
I was like in fifth.
Why do you remember that?
That's weird.
Why do you remember 2011?
Because I remember, I saw them. They were my first show August 17th, 2011.
So you went
Tuesday
to see them without really listening to them?
Actually, yes. That's how I got into them. Because it was really weird. I went home from my dad's, and then my mom and my stepdad were there in the time, and my stepdad was like a big like Blink fan. And he saw Mo going, and he had bought me a ticket. And then that night, I saw this to like Take Off Your Pants and Jacket.
What did he say?
Man.
Jordan listens to all these bands with numbers in their names.
Yeah, like he kept making like... to them, I just agree with them. Like, that's what they do. They jack off or something like that. I don't know. Or whatever.
These guys jack off all the time.
Agree with them or whatever. Like, they do that, Mom.
Not do
that. Yeah.
What if you agree to something horrible?
But like 2005. Dude,
makes for an interesting story.
Something.
Yo, remember when you were a kid and you just actually don't know shit?
Remember when you were 26 or 27 and still don't know shit?
No, we know shit. Yeah. I used to... There was a kid.
I run these streets.
I didn't used to do this. This happened one time.
Streets are mine.
I was probably like 8, and I took a CD and shoved it on my fingers, and then it just got stuck there.
Oh, I did that too! Roller Coaster Tycoon on the CD
you
for the cereal box.
You don't know shit.
Yeah.
You don't know shit.
And we had to break the CD, and I was so pissed off because it was Roller Coaster Tycoon, and I
had to break it.
Why didn't you butter it?
You know what I did?
buttered it? Did you butter it?
Yeah, I buttered it. I just got butter, and then I had to spin it like this, screw, to get it up.
What'd you just say?
You missed the conversation?
I dropped my phone. I got distracted.
Oh. Son of a bitch. Is it okay?
Yeah, it's already.
What kind of phone
what
is it?
Killed Skate Punk?
G7. What killed Skate Punk? Let me tell you from the 40-year-old fucking.
Is that a plane? A G7?
I've seen like 8 of those videos now. What killed? It's fucking.
No, dude, Finn McKenty, though, he's dope. Like, his content is dope. Like, he does all these, like, videos, but what he's like. Like a marketing guy in like the industry who does like a lot
look
of like
clickbait
does,
that fucking
dude yeah
thumbnail.
He's totally like he does like marketing for like GGD
and I'm not
like,
saying it's bad
JST,
I would probably
I think
click
like
on
GGD's,
that
like
GGD's
like a drums like the
really
tempted like,
to
Joey Sturgis
right
tones
now,
and then he
a little bit
but
what
he's also
it?
Like apparently he's been like a marketing guy for like
I did
fuck what was it apparently he's been like a marketing guy for like Febreze and like Abercrombie and Fitch or like something like that yeah so he's been like yeah, like I'm a marketing guy for like those all those kind of companies and shit. So
how do you become a marketing guy?
I don't know, but apparently school, he's
I
like
yeah, I know about the market.
Yeah, I've seen a couple of videos where he like
I know
yeah.
I want to
apply for the market.
The markets.
But I mean, if he like made that
I'm here
shit,
to apply for the market.
It's crazy.
Yeah, I'm here to apply for market. You sorry, are you like talking about kids?
Is that what you red call rocket? Him? A rod?
Yeah, fucking rod, man. The guy's got a
like
rod.
Like Rod Stewart?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Rod Stewart. You got
rod
poking out, man.
And he had a big fucking erect dick laying on the floor, and it was all red and shit. And I looked at my mom, and like, I looked at my mom, like, "Hey, Hummer's bleeding." I
oh
was bleeding.
Dog's,
but just, yeah,
dog's
a
doing
boner.
A thing.
Yeah,
Jesus
dumb.
Christ, man.
And just, they're like,
"It's got a big old dick boner."
That's what he was doing. Think about fucking, I don't know.
Angels and Airwaves.
But it's funny when you think about the dogs. Like, I just imagine like some dopey person just going like.
Yeah, what are they thinking about, man?
Yeah. With their like mouth open, yeah. They're just like, yeah.
When's dinner time?
Yeah.
Fuck
oh, it's
me.
Dinner every time.
Oh.
They whack themselves off and they suck their own cock, dogs. You ever see that when they fucking suck in their own dick?
I don't know, you just.
Like, Jesus Christ.
God.
Dog seems all right.
Yeah.
So, the fuck, man?
So what we can deduce is you've had horrible, substantial trauma due to this dog boner.
Yes, very bad. I think Gross or that, man.
Oh.
What?
Is my hair?
Yeah. I'm fucking intrigued, man.
Okay.
Tell me.
Yeah.
I'm going to hijack it with fucking gross shit.
No, what? Don't play no gross shit. Gross.
No, no playing of the gross shit.
I don't play gross. No gross.
This is how you go to jail. This is how you incriminate yourself.
For sex, I am not coming.
What the fuck? That was to catch a predator.
Yeah.
Oh, fuck.
That was so
funny.
I was thinking about that specific scene at work the other day, and I spit on my own lips because I was trying to hold the laugh in. I'm surrounded by people that are like way too serious, and I'm like, if I laugh... they might fire me.
Oh, I know. They're like, what? What's going
insane?
On?
Yeah.
Oh,
so
fuck.
You should have
just
said it
like
out
this.
Loud.
I started flexing my arms like this, and I'm like,
nobody look at me.
Like, you're going to explode? You're going to take off?
You're just like,
and then your lip quivers a little, like,
yeah, you're trying to say something, you're like, you just like kind of walk. You like turn your head
and
away.
If
and
anybody,
panic.
If anybody talks to you, you think about it twice as hard. And
yeah.
It gets even funnier.
Yeah, what are you doing here? For six, I'm not coming. In the back of your head, he's trying to tell you like how to do a T4 slip or some shit. For six, I'm not
right.
coming.
Taxes.
Your brain is the ultimate saboteur.
Yeah.
It's just like, okay.
You're going down, buddy.
Oh, man. Yeah. That was so... howling and laughter, dude. I used to do that at Walmart because I put my earbuds in. I fucking just work carts all day. And I listen to, like, Opie and Anthony bits. They're, like, fucking with the doctor.
Some of them are fucked up, though.
I know.
Did you guys have...
So funny.
...the mechanical cart operation?
We did, but we only
machine.
Used it for a few months, and it broke down. We just pushed it around. Pushed around, I found easier.
That's
mine.
That's the Motorola Razr, I think.
I don't know what it is.
You said it was the G7.
G7 Razr.
It's pretty cool.
Something
I
like
cracked
that.
It within the first few days.
Oh, wait,
my
that's my
got
phone,
it,
isn't it?
It broke. But,
it is now.
No, like the same phone that I have.
Oh, well, you got the
I thought you had
back.
the Razr phone.
I have the
You
essential.
Have the Razr? Everybody's got the Razr right
like
now?
Similar.
No, I got the essential phone.
Oh,
they're out of business now.
Essential, yes.
I didn't know.
It's amazing.
Is it bezel-less, though?
I think Samsung. Samsung does the G's, right?
I'm distracted by this phone.
I don't know.
I want a Pixel 3.
I think so. V6 or something.
Yeah. I know nothing about them.
Neither.
I've seen
them. But I like their cameras.
Yeah, oh, they're really nice.
The Huawei P2, though. P20, sorry, P20.
It's pretty cool, man.
I don't like the name of it.
I know the name. The name's a little...
It's a little foreign.
I did this thing.
Weird, like, RBC ad.
Shout out to the foreigners.
But it's like got like four cameras or three cameras, and it takes low-light photos. Like, there was a flash in the room.
You took a nice poop.
Balanced, and it's not noisy at all.
Conversation shouldn't happen. Cool.
I think we've got
six. What's the fucking ad?
I'm talking to myself. You two are talking. This guy's
nice
talking.
Though, it's shiny
we'll let
stuff.
Them commit.
Commit, guys. Just commit.
Oh, it's wrapping up.
Hey,
cool,
sorry
though.
To interrupt. I'm do sure it just sounds like
I
chaotic.
Don't even
what's
know
that?
What I'm...
Do it.
Do what?
Do it.
Huh?
Do it?
Do what?
Do it?
Do it.
Yar.
Do it, man.
Okay.
Do it. Do it. Hey, hey. It's fucking...
Do it.
I want you to do it right now. Don't hesitate. Do it. You're trying to fuck with me. Don't hesitate. Just fucking do it, okay? Pretend.
Here it comes.
Like, just do it.
Impersonations.
Impersonations? Who am I impersonating, why?
I don't know. You tell me.
No, why? Don't hesitate the question. Fucking say it. Do it.
Dude,
ask it, why?
Who are you impersonating?
I don't know.
I'm blown away.
I don't know what you guys are talking about.
You fuck.
Switch
you're
voices.
The one talking.
just like on the walk cast, I also agree you could be the greatest voice actor. The walk cast. That's what it's called, right?
Oh, that's right, yes.
Yeah.
A walk show.
Yeah, I believe yeah, the walk show. Whoops.
Yeah.
I believe he mentioned you should be a voice actor.
Yeah, I don't know where do you start with that stuff? Huh?
You just start recording lines like that.
I've got a fucking my vocals at
home.
If
you could just pull them out like that, dude. You just sit there and record lines and then just post. Do 300 of them.
300?
Yeah.
300.
Just do like some give or take
YouTube,
one shots
and then just dump them everywhere.
Yeah.
Dude, Waze.
What on like SoundCloud?
The app.
Yeah.
You can record your own voice for the
whoa.
GPS.
Really?
They this give you like a
smells.
List of.
Oh.
I know Terry Crews does a I know Terry Crews does a like voice acting on it.
It cleanses your palate.
I know it's we got a lot of that right there.
Smells like vanilla.
What about my inside palate?
What about my inside
fix
palate?
It.
Okay.
Yeah.
Fix it. Fix your inside palate.
So yeah, would
fix.
You is that something you'll pursue?
I guess he's
start
got some footage of me. You
got some. I already got some recordings of me, my first voiceover.
Yeah, we're actually putting it in one of your songs.
That's right.
Yeah. I heard about that too. You just stood there and did random shit. Into
yeah,
the mic.
We got this cool
yeah,
microphone.
Like
Adam got it, and
that's
it's
so
a
funny.
It's a harmonica. It's labeled as a harmonica microphone, but the way it looks like is like one of those, just like handheld. It's just like a circle that you kind of just hold.
Dude,
and
I was
just kind of looks like an old like a two way radio kind
of
thing.
I was trying to make one of those.
Okay.
And it
so how does that sound? What kind of sound?
It
is
just
that?
Gives it like literally like an old
dirty.
Radio kind of dirty
oh, okay.
vibe, and
okay.
it's and it's a little bit more clean though. It's a little bit more clean because it's like you know,
oh,
but
we're
still
cleaning
dirty.
It up.
Well, like
we're
it's what I mean.
Up.
It's like it's mid range focus,
but dirty.
But it has doesn't have a lot of high end, so it gives it that radio because of like old radio kind of when you hear that effect like within the EQ it doesn't have a lot of high end, so the mic just doesn't have a lot of high end. So naturally,
so
when you put
like
it in a mix, it just sounds
in a
like
truck
yeah.
calling to another
yeah.
truck.
Yeah. And he was doing like an impersonation of like women's wrestling, like
oh,
I'm yeah, supposed
yeah,
to.
I have a punch of Susan right straight in the cunt.
And
went on more than
yeah,
about
I don't know, just like
up.
Some there you're doing like sports announcers for like baseball and like wrestling
yeah,
and shit. Like,
falls a fucking doubleheader. The answer to that Kardashian dies for the ball, he bruises in the cup or something.
Wow.
John Gibbons takes a shit on the fourth.
I remember that game.
Yeah, remember that one? He's fucking in the background. Like he matters. Fucking piece of shit.
That's
hey,
hilarious.
John Gibbons, you listen to this. Fuck you, John Gibbons.
Yo, you smoked him.
Hey, fuck you, John Gibbons. What are you doing over there? Are you fucking CSI? This guy over here, he's a PI.
Enhancing.
He's a PI. Get
he's,
him.
He's
recording something.
I was going to just tell Ian to look at his cellular telephone.
Yeah, well, I'll look at mine, too.
I don't have your phone number.
I feel like you lying.
But I was looking to make one of those harmonica microphones out of an old-school telephone.
Like a rotary?
Just out of...
Let me show you what I'm talking about here, Vita. So you get your dirty, dirty effects.
Oh, my God.
You unscrew it. All right. Following mm-hmm. along?
Yeah.
You drill it?
Uh-huh.
With your backer? What? Stick an audio jack in
How is the audience going to know what you're showing me?
Zoom in right there, people.
This is personal. This is personal times.
Yeah, it's a personal check.
But yeah, it seems very, very easy to make. It's not really that interesting to look at. I don't know why I'm showing you. I should show you.
See, I choose to go the more traditional route of taking a can and a string and a can.
That you get pretty old school sound that way.
You know, like when you're reliable. It's more of, it's not like a truck to truck kind of sound.
Yeah.
It's more of like a wagon to wagon.
Nice. I love those.
Wow.
Whoa.
Yeah. I remember when when the pioneers were traveling across the West and they used to communicate can, string, can between.
For sure, man. The wagon. For sure.
Between the wagons.
Fucking Mennonites still do that. They're fucking 35 years old. Still
what would you
Geno
imagine?
Who gives
what
a
would
fuck?
You imagine?
Hey, there's some Mennonites that cheat. They, or I don't know if it's cheating, but they're just.
They go to Walmart.
And they drive minivans.
Oh, yeah. That's
true.
Fucking fake.
Yeah. They're allowed to do it as long as it's not flashy or like something like that. So if it's just black.
Some
they just drive black everything, right?
They're living the life.
Yeah. I don't think they pay tax. Apparently, they're allowed to just cheat and have electricity. And
cheat
cars.
On each other?
Really?
With their siblings?
Yeah.
Yes, their siblings.
What lucky people.
Oh, yeah.
They just bane away.
It smells
whenever
great
they
out there, too.
Yeah.
Whenever you drive through, like,
I don't even
Mennonite
think that's the animals.
Areas.
Mennonite country.
Yeah, me neither.
I think that's coming straight
country.
From their house.
That's coming straight from their house.
Yeah.
No country for old Mennonite.
Yeah. No country
for That's a YouTube series waiting to happen.
Man, fucking Mennonites, man. When they're fucking on the side of the road driving
they're
with their big horse.
Oh,
yes. I remember one time I drove into like a Mennonite town.
Yeah.
And I went into this convenience store because I needed to buy like a lighter, like whatever. But the inside, they like made their own flour and clothing.
A lighter or
that they
whatever?
Sold it. Yeah. So like I think it was like a lighter. I needed like cigarettes or something. I was like, I don't know. And I remember they were, like, making their own flour or whatever. Everything was, like, just handmade, all the clothing. Like, they had were some, like, bonnets and shit like that, like straw hats. Keep driving down the road, and then there's literally a line on the opposing lane of maybe 20 children just on little small bikes just in, like, single file just the other way. And I'm just like, holy shit, I drove past. There's the school, and they're, like, teachers are just waving them down.
All came from the same mom.
Yeah, all came from.
That's horrible.
That's so weird.
When I was working at John's Nursery, I guess they drove down one of the streets because we worked out in St. Jacob's. That's where the shop was. And the guy turned the corner and a wild horse just like ran down the hill and he fucking drove right into it, killed the horse. And the Mennonites weren't very happy about that.
Holy
shit.
Smash the car up. Like the truck
of
got,
course.
The truck got fucked
of
up.
Of course.
Cop had to come and put the horse down.
Right. Some horse laying there
right
with
on the spot, man.
Twitching.
Fucking blew. Just fucking blew it.
If this doesn't go to show the audience how Ontarian these stories are.
Oh,
I never
man.
Really
well,
think
well,
about that. I never really
so
think
Ontario,
about
that.
The goose.
So Ontario.
Or the geese.
The goose.
The goose.
They walk amongst us.
They walk amongst us.
Not
they
right now, thank us. Fucking God.
Fucking shit animals.
I hate
guys,
them.
Guys.
I hate
guys,
everything.
Guys. They are a national treasure.
I don't give a shit. We need a new one.
What would
we need a new one.
What
a balloon.
What, yeah. What would our national.
Beaver. Always.
What about the elk?
I was thinking.
I'm thinking of all. I'm thinking of all the money animals.
The caribou
kills every elk.
I was thinking.
Yeah, he's also
the squirrel.
So he's fucking killing elk. Right? He doesn't. He's not on a podcast.
No, just those nasty garbage squirrels.
Garbage. That's squirrels. Right. I hate garbage squirrels.
Those
man.
Would taste disgusting if they're garbage.
Yeah.
Garbage squirrels are garbage.
Have you had squirrel brains?
Oh, but you'd want
squirrel.
You'd want like a triple
no
star.
I still have no brains.
Squirrel.
I don't know. I'm not really like. I don't really care how.
You.
I don't know.
You want squirrel brains?
I'm not gonna get into it.
Are you
I don't
still?
Want
Ian wants squirrel brains.
Are you? Are you mastering and producing songs for them?
Yeah. So we just
yes.
got like one that they've already recorded, and I'm just working on the mix.
Cool.
Gonna
gang
get
vocals.
To them pretty
Does
soon.
It sound
yes.
great?
Very cool.
I think it's pretty banging.
I think it's pretty banging. We're coming at you live from Dave's 105.
105 point rod, baby.
105 point rod.
How do you dial in
www.105.
Just dial in rock on the phone. Rock.
But yeah, it's, I think it's going pretty good.
Cool.
I don't know.
I listened.
It's fun recording of it.
What's the last song you guys put out?
Lost Days.
Lost Days. That right? That's right. That shit sounds awesome.
Thanks, bud. Yeah.
Got the video for it and everything.
Yeah, the fucking vid, man.
Yeah.
Got
it on the tube.
Got on the fucking tube, man. Let me tell you, I just put it on that tube and I just slapped it down.
Put it
said,
on
hey,
right now, man.
That's what it's gonna be.
Do you wanna
showcase,
show your song to the rest of the world?
Expose yourself to
all
us.
Nine of them.
Yeah. All nine songs. I don't even think we have nine. I think we have four and a half. All nine.
Hey, where am I? Oh, I'm supposed to be looking here.
Yeah, where do you want
the screen?
I'm looking
works
on the thing up there.
Yes.
Yo, bad motherfucker, want you back then?
Thanks, man.
But yeah, that last tune, it sounds like nice and inspired by like.
Thanks, man.
Yeah, no problem.
That's cool, man.
I'm glad you dig it, dude.
Yeah,
sure.
Thanks, guy. What?
It's got potential, man.
It's got potential. Hey, potential. Oh, hi. Oh, where are you running from, Jordy?
Where was this filmed?
Behind my old school, Our Lady of Grace School.
Where's that?
It's in, do you know like where St. Mary's is? St. Mary's High School? It's like a little past that. You go upwards.
Down?
Opposite way, kind of towards Forest Glen.
Okay.
Didn't you guys say that you got to film in a factory too?
Yeah, that's where the band stuff is. In Zach's factory.
What factory?
How'd you get access to
Zach
that?
Factory?
Zach's, you,
that's where
Zach
they
factory.
Zach's, man.
Hey, Ron.
like a Lego creature.
So, teaching everybody how to walk.
On the fucking drums there.
Yeah. We had like an hour and a half to film all their band stuff.
Awesome. You guys like have to pay, or they're just like, okay.
No, they just let us in. There's just
seems like a kind factory.
Wait, they might come in here at some point. But they're like, you gotta just put our name somewhere, right?
If I asked that, they'd be like, fuck no.
We killed chickens.
You just gotta put our name somewhere, and I watch this. The fucking company name will pop up because like,
Phil's right there.
They told you to put your name in there.
They don't make Zacks, they make films.
And it says, Phil Joy.
What a deceiving place.
Go back, go back.
Okay, let's go back to it.
Oh, I think his forehead just bumped into the mic. That was awesome.
Oh, did it? I'm sorry. Is it this? Oh, I'm sorry.
Are you guys? I'm
a random shot. So out of place. Field trek.
Yeah.
Did
should
was, that,
just
oh, was that part of the deal?
Yeah. He's like, just
we'll
give us a shout out.
Field trek.
They're like,
all right, quick, get a picture of it.
They're like, just give us a shout out. Like, okay. And then Nick, the guy who made the video, he saw and he put that
there's
in there.
There's also a deleted scene with the guy who works at the factory explaining what the factory does.
Yeah,
I decided not to include it in the music
video.
Well,
we sold a couple
and
other places that are in need of filtration. We sold it to them. But anyways.
Whose idea was it to film in this place?
We were trying to find a place to film, and then Zach said, my work will probably let me. And
that is such a strange thing to suggest.
And then someone's car, like, behind, right in the
way.
Yeah, those are
those
fattest friends'
cars. Those are nice
cars,
too, aren't they?
One's like a Camaro, and one's some else. I don't know.
Ian, you should
give me one car name.
No, it's something
wrong.
Yeah,
car name.
All I know is
there's one Camaro and then a Corolla.
Yeah. My mic.
What's wrong with that?
Yeah.
So whose vehicles were those?
Addie's friend.
He just called it a favor? Did he have to advertise them too?
He said, we'll put your Instagram stuff in the post.
You just put
Phil
Trek on the side of both cars.
Trek. Actually, if you...
Who filmed it?
Produced and engineered. So it was his whole idea. We recorded it at a cottage. He's like, I just want to go somewhere random and record it at a random place.
Wicked.
Yeah, so we went up to like a cottage for a weekend and record the whole song in the day. We stayed up there like a couple days, and then a month later, he's like, okay, let's film the video for it and put it out properly.
How long did you have to play at this factory for?
We were there an hour shooting all the band footage.
Holy fuck.
What equipment did you guys bring to the cottage to record it?
He brought, for interfaces, he brought a Focusrite. He just bought a bunch of SM57s and whatnot off of Kijiji and whatever else he had at home he brought. And Fatty, if he was here, he'd be telling me he uses fucking drum punnies. He takes those everywhere and he puts them on the drums and they kind of muffle the sound, I guess.
Yeah.
And we just did it there straight in the living room.
That's really cool. That's a really cool idea to just like take the people you're going.
Last week about a recording session that I heard happen where a band for like I don't recall who they were, so that part of the story is diminished.
We don't know.
It's a relatively famous band. That's all I remember. But they paid like $190 to have a whole record recorded over the course of one night, and they just went to a church with one mic and just recorded that.
Oh damn!
Holy fuck, dude.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
How did it turn out?
It's a massive record. I heard it on Alan Cross. I'll have to go back to the episode to
Easy
hear what
core.
The record was.
Post hardcore.
All of you guys would know the name. Like I know that much.
Angels and Airwaves.
Just Tom Long's echoed vocal.
What are you the same?
I miss you.
So
miss
like,
you.
How did Illicit begin?
Illicit begin?
Yeah.
Okay. So
take us way back.
Take
us to the roots.
September 2016. Yes, when the air was just a bit finer back then, wasn't it, ladies and gentlemen?
yes.
And anyways, so basically, Ethan, our old sinner,
your old sinner.
Did I say sinner?
I heard stainer.
Oh, giving those nice little Hershey
sinner,
squirts.
Stainer. Yeah.
Our old Skinner.
Our old little stainer.
Yes.
Our old stainer.
Nice. Sounds like a great guy.
Yeah. Hit me up on Kijiji because I've been putting up ads for like 3 years looking for bands and stuff.
Holy shit.
I swear, 3 years I tried out people, nothing worked.
What?
Nothing worked.
I'm telling you, this city is weird.
It's fucking weird, man.
That is insane persistence.
Yes.
Is it the same ad?
I would give up after like
3 hours.
But
you persevered and you came through.
Different ads, different pictures.
So did you...
Different categories, different everything.
Did you have people...
Pets.
Message you?
Yes, I did. I get together with them to jam, and they were either...
Ivan.
You know some shit.
What?
They're either
what
fucking weirdos. I went to this one guy's house. This was like 2 years before the band started.
Craft dinner, buddy.
Yeah. Super Bowl was on at the time, I believe.
Brought up the chili dogs.
Yeah, brought the fucking chili dogs in the wings. Put them on my back. I just put the sauce on my back.
Wow.
Okay.
Jesus. You really took us back.
So some guy hit me up and he's like, I'm from like Cambridge area or whatever. I want to start a band. I can sing. I'm like, okay, cool, man. I want to do that too. What band do you listen to? And he went back and forth. I'm like, okay, cool. I'll learn some Sum 41 covers. What not? And,
did you like Sum 41 before?
Yeah. I liked all those bands and whatever. And so he's like, okay. Avril Lavigne.
Chad Kroger.
I
saw Nickelback last
Daughtry.
Year, I swear to God.
Was it good?
Dude, I fucking...
They write perfect songs.
They're fucking good songs, man.
They're just like... They're too perfect.
Their shows bring
so
many people.
It's like a Kendall.
Where are all of those fans, though?
Everywhere,
like
man.
But when the band's not playing, like where the fuck do they all go?
I don't know.
Everybody just goes silent. They're like, I hate Nickelback.
I know. I don't know what it is. Dude, that place sold out in like a day.
All of their shows are just always sold out. 16,000.
Fucking amphitheater. It's crazy. It's fucking nuts.
What's their crowd like?
Women.
And children.
Average people.
Six of them, actually.
Women and average people.
Yeah, you know, just your average lookers.
Walk around the place.
And then there's some drunk lady. Came out, hey, you're in my seat.
No, I'm not.
There are no seats, lady.
Oh, you were in a seat.
I was in a seat. I was just right before
Nickelback in a seat?
Yeah, it was like right before.
Oh, it's one of those.
Oh, man.
It's like the amphitheater, right? And they only have that one area.
Oh, I got you.
Less than 1,000.
So.
Before, a good seat. I saw them. Anyways, so I hit that fucking guy up, right? The GG.
Learn a few songs. And I go to his place. He's like, I'm 18 or whatever. I'm like, okay, cool. That works out. 17.
Perfect. You're legal.
Yeah. And so I go there, and when I park up front, I see like a blind open and this bald dude. And I'm kind of like looking, and I'm like, is that it?
Jesus Christ.
I'm going to be here for a bit.
bit. I got a ride here.
Fuck. I'm Nick. And it's him, the guy who looks like a father. And it's fucking that guy.
And he said he was 18?
Said he was 18. He looked like 36.
18 going on 40.
I stressed 36, and we went upstairs to his bedroom. He still lived at home. His bedroom at home. And
how haven't you bailed yet?
I was in there, man. I was just like, Kyle just dropped me off.
All right. I've got no other choice.
I got no choice. I got to be in here. And so we went upstairs to his room. And I'm like, we're just making small talk or whatever. And I notice, I look around his room, and there's like Kinect, you know those Kinect toys?
Yeah.
You build like roller coasters? They're scattered amongst the room. And I forgot to mention this part.
Was this the room of a 6-year-old?
It looked like it. He collected Monster Energy cans.
They were on a shelf. And I forgot to tell you this part. He had three.
Wow, those are some vintage items.
All Airborne CDs. Yo, this is an Airborne. And so I pull out my car,
and he points to my Sum 41 sticker, and it's like, nice Minor Threat sticker.
I'm like, gee, thanks, man. Like, I didn't know what to say. I was like, thanks, man. I'm like, so you want to play Hell Song? He's like, I didn't learn any songs. I'm like,
what?
Oh, okay.
Did you feel like you were about to be murdered?
Yeah, he was there to fuck you.
I think, honestly, he was on the he was slow.
That sounds like...
He was on the spectrum. You said a little salt and pepper shake of it.
Jesus.
Yeah, just a little tap.
Oh,
little
I was tap. Supposed to learn a song?
Yeah, and then like
great. We're just sitting there and he's just showing me bands and sitting on his bed.
I like this band.
He showed me a Spanish like punk band that I know that he doesn't know. He
that was just, band was the Mars Volta.
Mars Volta.
I know.
Was it?
I know it wasn't. Oh, I don't know what the fuck it was
like,
called.
Holy shit, man.
Drummer from Queens of Stone Age is the one that played with the Mars Volta.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
Mars Volta, that's a band.
That is a band.
You ever listen to that band?
I heard like
one song from them.
Oh,
years
dude.
Ago.
You should just get into that.
Mars Volta?
Oh, dude. Yeah.
Mars Volta?
Yeah.
Don't get me started, sir.
Okay.
That shit is fucking just crazy musicianship.
Yeah.
It's like, that is like, it's like, I don't even know how to describe it. It's like crazy fast. Like,
their drummer sounds like they plucked him from the jungle. Like, he's just like,
this guy with crazy
just
hair,
rocking, but he's got like a good
just
like
rocking
punk,
around,
kind of like hardcore.
Oh, really?
Like he's just got that good kind of vibe that he kind of knows, how to keep, like that high energy, like a rock kind of energy. But the rest of the band has this
like psychedelic prog,
like Spanish prog kind of thing.
Oh. And the lead singer's vocals are incredibly unique.
What's a good like?
Oh, Goliath, the Mars Volta Goliath.
Sounds big.
I don't recall if it's a really long song.
This one?
Yeah.
That seems to be the one.
Oh, they have a violin player.
Hey.
Sound going?
Phil Trek.
I don't know. I've never seen a video for it.
Where's their Phil Trek ad, man? What the fuck?
How come they didn't have to do it?
I hear a sound. Oh, there we go.
Good morning.
Look at that band.
Yeah, look, there's just like so much
that's
going
wild.
On.
Yeah. Is that guy got electric maracas? What is that costume?
Yeah.
Does he always wear that?
No.
The time signatures too are just so cool and peppered in there nicely.
Yeah. Now they do have some very strange music as well.
This isn't strange.
Sorry. Oh, it's way more.
Oh
strange.
Yeah.
This is like
the most digestible form of the Mars Volta.
Maybe like Televators.
Yeah,
probably
that too.
Digestible. Out of all their songs, I guess. But this is like the high energy kind of
People can relate to it at least. Like you can imagine hearing this on a show and probably wanting to get pretty hyped to it.
I feel like there's some Santeria shit about to go down. Bring out the chicken, sweat his throat.
Yeah, this is quite a bizarre video. For just a band playing, there's some concept going on. What the concept is, nobody really knows.
Phil Trek.
So did you guys try to, like, make a story for your music video?
Well, Dan came up the idea of having someone get chased by people with like makeup on or just creepy masks and stuff. And this is just gonna become.
That was the story?
Yeah, just like.
Imagine this! A guy gets chased.
Imagine this.
People have masks on.
I don't feel when I say this, but imagine a guy gets chased.
Now, wait. If I didn't have you there, they have makeup on.
They got makeup on, man, okay? So we can filter it out, man. Yeah? But like, you want. Like a psych ward and shit like that, and he's trying to.
Like Shutter Island?
Yeah. Kind of. Yeah. And then it kind of just like melded into this, me getting chased by like my demons or whatever.
What are your demons? What demons were chasing? The T?
The Red Rocket?
The
Red Rocket.
Yeah, no doubt. Food poisoning?
The guy who went to jail with?
Oh.
What was that guy's name? The guy you went to jail with? Nick?
Yeah.
That's quite a demon to run away from.
Yeah,
you
Nick,
hear that?
I think about that all the time. It's
you hear that, everybody?
Demon.
If Nick messages you to play any music,
and he's from.
Make sure he knows the songs before.
Yeah, make sure he knows
the
songs.
That's for a snippet at least.
Yeah.
Can you play In Too Deep?
He can play fucking nuts.
Did he even have an instrument?
Oh my god, he had a mic. I forgot about this, and it was a $15 Walmart mic.
Like,
I got it from Walmart.
Oh, yeah, but
it's a yak back.
He borrowed it from like his parents' karaoke machine.
Cool. Yeah.
Mom, can I borrow this? No, we're doing karaoke today.
Yeah.
Jordan's coming over.
Come on.
He's a real professional musician.
This is my big break.
Don't embarrass me.
He tried getting me over there like fucking again too. At the end when I was leaving, I'm like, hey man, I gotta get going.
I gotta get the fuck out of here, man. This is weird.
You fucking me out here,
I thought we were friends.
I can only eat so much salami.
He's like, you know, I gotta go to my dad's house next week, but after that, you come over. I'm like, yeah, man, we'll figure it out. We'll see.
And you never figured it out.
I can just fucking.
Yes. Just get back into contact with him.
I could find him, dude. Nick Torres.
Next week's guest.
Nick Torres. Yeah, I'll do some investigative journalism. I'll find
him.
No. Let's not witch hunt somebody.
Oh, yeah.
We'll do it in private. It's way
Oh, yeah.
Fun.
We'll do it private. Yes, yeah. Private Facebook.
Send it in the Discord.
Yes.
So what do you think of this tune? Is this, like, too much?
I like the chorus. I like the singing part.
What about this?
Yes.
Listen to these vocals.
Oh, they're done. Just cut the band out.
It's tough to focus on music like this when you're in an environment.
Yeah.
Like, that's not just headphones.
It's true.
Uh-oh. I'm just going to do it.
Fuck you on.
Unbelievable. This is embarrassing.
Wow. I can't believe this.
I can't believe
I like the chorus part. I like that.
Dude. How can you do that? Sick. What did you get out of that?
Prize?
What was the story?
Song?
What was the story that you
whatever
saw?
You want to speak about.
This, I like that chorus.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, very nice.
How long ago was that?
The chorus?
Yes.
Yeah, we're that keeping one. Track. We have an Excel spreadsheet.
We do.
We have a column for all of our guests that's going to say, when did you like the chorus?
Yes.
When did I like the chorus?
And do you still like it?
What time? I still like the chorus. I guess it's got to be 8. It must have been like 7:57. I like the chorus at.
Write that down.
Okay. I like the chorus
down.
Then.
My Excel spreadsheets.
On his hand.
Really expelling.
Yes. I like that.
7:57.
Okay. We're going to need you to sign a release on that.
Yeah. I'll sign a release. I will
actually,
fucking.
You're not going to touch anything.
None of this happened. Oh, it's still going, or is it replay?
Actually, believe it or not, this is the chorus.
Whoa!
What?
Yeah, second chorus.
Just
kidding. So what number?
Would you like to revise your answer?
5 p.m., so that's got to be like...
Oh, you're talking time.
I was...
Unbelievable. Interesting. 7 hours and 57 minutes.
Whoa! God, you got a long one.
I know you
said to. I'm a quicker when I wanted to.
Oh my god.
I think I'm gonna head out.
What's happening to him? What have we done?
Say like 135, that's when the chorus was.
Not a second.
No? Okay.
I'm looking for an answer and you're not giving it to me.
I'm looking for an answer. I say 156, that's not even on the chorus.
Okay.
I feel like it's pretty early.
Hey, so as we're getting like sort of closer to wrapping it up, did you think it went pretty well?
Yeah.
The podcast?
Yeah. Yeah, I was a little nervous at the start, but
were you going like this, like my Dragon Ball Z charge?
Dude, I was even worse.
Are you sweating?
Yeah.
Okay. Are
you sweating? I'm sweating.
I just have to make sure you were nervous.
Yeah.
That's good. Yeah.
I wasn't nervous. Yeah. I was just uncomfortable with the idea.
You could say he was common ready on the surface.
The idea that we've been
sitting on for fucking 17 months.
3 months.
It's been 17, you fool.
17. It's only been 3 months, right?
Yeah, only.
This is like month number three. Top of month number three.
We're peaking.
It's only downhill from here.
Yeah. Sorry, guys.
Do you guys feel like it took too long?
No.
No.
Or do you think it was the right amount of time? You know?
Well, we only really met up once a week, so if you think about it collectively,
we spent like
a week and a half on it.
Well, we actually are garbage. We actually only spent 2 hours setting this up.
Yeah. No, but it was just getting all like the kinks figured out with like the, you know, the microphones and all the levels and, you know, just the equipment. The internet was pretty much built.
Yeah.
Like I think if we hadn't got the internet set up a little bit earlier,
I'm glad we just didn't like put out something shitty.
I agree. You ever put out some shitty thing?
Ever
put out some shitty? Oh boy, I put out the shitty all the time.
I fucked that up. I take it back.
I fucked up that shitty.
Fucking Shane from Silverstein. I got one of our old demos that didn't sound that good.
Was Nick featured on it?
Nick, you know, Nick was in my heart.
That's all that matters.
Yeah. He was in my heart.
He was the...
Dude, I fucking dropped his name, but I didn't drop the last word. The last word.
Whoever said that's a complete sad.
Damn you.
Who do you think answer people who's got a bigger pain?
What? Who's got a bigger pain? Who are our options?
Out of who?
No, I just want them to guess. Just send who they think has one. As like a big one out of anybody.
Oh, you're speaking to people.
Okay.
Yes.
You're not speaking to these people.
He's transcended the analog realm.
He's in the cyber
realm.
Harambe.
Harambe?
Yeah. Harambe had the biggest dong.
His dick got shot off.
Well, Harambe. I mean, his dick is not active anymore, but I think
it's not active.
This member has not been active. Yeah. 2 years.
Can
you believe it?
Interesting.
Quite the member.
Why is it interesting?
It's not.
Yeah.
That's just one of those filler words that sometimes you just
interesting.
You just say it so you can think of something else better to say.
Interesting.
You know? Like that
that's
one
rather
too.
Interesting.
Interesting.
That's a good
one. Yeah, all of us have programmed words and Jordan just goes
That gets you a lot farther.
That's
though.
An interesting technique.
Yeah, it's like
you're just like that shows that your brain is working overtime.
What are you doing?
What are you doing here?
You think about it. You know, get out of that.
For sex, I'm not coming.
Oh my god.
Hey, on that note,
who's gonna come first?
Not me.
I was before the pod. Oh yeah, back to talking about how long it took to set up the podcast. Yes. I was trying to think of something cool to say when we started it today. Like I was trying to think of like a funny joke. And do you want to hear what I came up with and just decided not to say?
Why didn't you say it?
Because
scared.
No, I didn't hash it out enough. I didn't have the wording down pat.
Should we?
Oh yes, you are speaking to me.
Should we? Just save it for the next week.
No, because I'll never work on it again.
I think you should. I think you should make it your thing.
I don't want to do. Okay, fine.
Okay, well, tell us anyways.
Nope.
Yeah, tell us.
Next week I'll come
okay,
in with
come
a
on,
real...
I just ruined it for everybody.
Either a real banger of a joke or I'll be laughed okay. right out of Hollywood.
I want to know what you had prepared today.
No, no, no.
I'll tell you.
It's gonna. I got to work on this
joke. It's going to be different next week.
No, pretty Is much it? Be the same.
No,
it's
you just told like me it's going to be different.
All right, I was going to say...
Yes.
Welcome to the Ape Audio Podcast, sponsored by 23andYou, the only DNA testing service where you pin down your friend and get them to spit in a vial.
Fuck yeah.
That's pretty good. Or jizz in it.
You should have went with that. Should have went with that.
Was that good?
That was good.
Yeah.
All right, I'll prepare another one.
Should we start? You're going to get a fresh joke?
No, not right now. Next week.
No, you need to do one right now.
No, I...
I got a fresh joke for you. I was thinking about this today at work.
Yeah,
I was
somebody bail me out here.
I forgot about it. I was going to come in and go, hope you guys aren't prone to cuts because Mr. Sharp's in town.
Oh, my God. Nice. Were they prone to cuts?
I don't know. You tell me.
Provolone?
You guys feel cut up now?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I feel pretty, pretty hurt. Pretty hurt. Heard from all these cuts.
Heard from all these cuts. Oh, that's a good song.
I'm hurting from all your cuts.
Nice. Do you guys want to wrap this up?
Sure.
Okay.
Yeah, man.
What do we say to
well, thanks
anybody out there?
Thanks for tuning in, guys. It was you know, it was a pleasure.
Thanks.
Hanging out.
Thanks.
And,
yeah.
Having you to get to know us a little bit.
Yeah. Thanks for checking it out. We'll be back next Tuesday, 5 p.m. Eastern time.
Sharp this time.
Thanks, Jordan, for coming to hang out.
Thanks.
Yeah.
Thanks for coming.
Thanks, Alan, for showcasing your Bing-Bong-Bowl.
Yeah. That was tight.
Thanks, Evan. I heard you sneeze in the corner. That's all he contributed.
That's crazy.
All right.
See you. Bye. Thank
Good night.
You.